This is Audible.
Hachette Audio presents Infinite Jest, written by David Foster Wallace, read by Sean Pratt. Publisher's note. From time to time, the listener will hear a female voice announce numbers. These refer to the novel's endnotes, a device well known to fans of Infinite Jest. By turns, descriptive and digressive, definitive and satiric, the notes are an important part of David Foster Wallace's work. Since we are unable to include them in this recording, we nevertheless wanted to acknowledge their existence and allow the serious student of the novel to follow along with the text, pausing and reading particular citations as they emerge. We hope that you find our approach helpful. Year of Glad. I am seated in an office, surrounded by heads and bodies. My posture is consciously congruent to the shape of my hard chair. This is a cold room in university administration, wood-walled, Remington-hung, double-windowed against the November heat, insulated from administrative sounds by the reception area outside, at which Uncle Charles, Mr. DeLint, and I were lately received. I am in here. Three faces have resolved into place above summer-weight sport coats and half-Windsors across a polished pine conference table, shiny with the spidered light of an Arizona noon. These are three deans of admissions, academic affairs, athletic affairs. I do not know which face belongs to whom. I believe I appear neutral, maybe even pleasant, though I've been coached to err on the side of neutrality and not attempt what would feel to me like a pleasant expression or smile. I have committed to crossing my legs, I hope carefully, ankle on knee, hands together in the lap of my slacks. My fingers are mated into a mirrored series of what manifests to me as the letter X. The interview room's other personnel include the university's director of composition, its varsity tennis coach, and academy pro-rector, Mr. A. DeLint. CT is beside me. The others sit, stand, and stand, respectively, at the periphery of my focus. The tennis coach jingles pocket change. There is something vaguely digestive about the room's odor. The high-traction sole of my complimentary Nike sneaker runs parallel to the wobbling loafer of my mother's half-brother, here in his capacity as headmaster, sitting in the chair to what I hope is my immediate right, also facing deans. The dean at left, a lean yellowish man whose fixed smile nevertheless has the impermanent quality of something stamped into uncooperative material, is a personality type I've come lately to appreciate, the type who delays need of any response from me by relating my side of the story for me, to me. Past a packet of computer sheets by the shaggy lion of a dean at center, he is speaking more or less to these pages, smiling down.
You are Harold Incandenza, 18, date of secondary school graduation approximately 1 month from now, attending the Enfield Tennis Academy, Enfield, Massachusetts, a boarding school where you reside.
His reading glasses are rectangular, court-shaped, the sidelines at top and bottom.
You are, according to Coach White and Dean Nelson, regionally, nationally, and continentally ranked junior tennis player, a potential ONANCAA athlete of substantial promise. Recruited by Coach White via correspondence with Dr. Tavis here, commencing February of this year.
The top page is removed and brought around neatly to the bottom of the sheaf at intervals.
You have been in residence at the Enfield Tennis Academy since age 7.
I am debating whether to risk scratching the right side of my jaw, where there is a win.
Coach White informs our officers that he holds the Enfield Tennis Academy's program and achievements in high regard, that the University of Arizona Tennis Squad has profited from the prior matriculation of several former ETA alumni, one of whom was one Mr. Aubrey F. DeLint, who appears also to be with you here today. Coach White and his staff have given us...
The Yellow Administrator's usage is on the whole undistinguished, though I have to admit he's made himself understood. The Director of Composition seems to have more than the normal number of eyebrows. The Dean at Wright is looking at my face a bit strangely. Uncle Charles is saying that though he can anticipate that the Deans might be predisposed to weigh what he avers as coming from his possible appearance as a kind of cheerleader for ETA, he can assure the assembled Deans that all this is true, and that the Academy has presently in residence no fewer than a third of the continent's top 30 juniors, in age brackets all across the board, and that I here, who go by Hal, usually, am right up there among the very cream. Right and center Dean smile professionally. The heads of DeLint and the coach incline as the Dean at left clears his throat.
Belief that you could well make, even as a freshman, a real contribution to this university's varsity tennis program. We are pleased, he either says or reads, removing a page, that a competition of some major sort here has brought you down and given us the chance to sit down and chat together about your application, and potential recruitment, and matriculation, and scholarship.
I've been asked to add that Hal here is seated third, boys 18 and under singles, in the prestigious Whataburger Southwest Junior Invitational out at the Randolph Tennis Center,
says what I infer is athletic affairs, his cocked head showing a freckled scalp.
Out at Randolph Park, near the outstanding Elkhorn Marriott, CT inserts. A venue the whole contingent's been vocal about finding absolutely top hole thus far.
Which, just so, Chuck. And that according to Chuck here, Hal has already justified his seed. He's reached the semifinals as of this morning's apparently impressive win. And that he'll be playing out at the center again tomorrow, against the winner of a quarterfinal game tonight. And so we'll be playing tomorrow at, I believe, scheduled for 08:30.
Try to get underway before the god-awful heat out there. Though, of course, a dry heat.
And has apparently already qualified for this winter's continental indoors up in Edmonton, Kirk tells me. Cocking further to look up and left at the varsity coach, whose smile's teeth are radiant against a violent sunburn.
Which is something indeed.
He smiles, looking at me. Did we get all that right, Hal? CT has crossed his arms casually. The triceps, flesh, is webbed with mottle in the air-conditioned sunlight.
You sure did, Bill.
He smiles. The two halves of his mustache never quite match.
And let me say, if I may, that Hal's excited. Excited to be invited for the third year running to the Invitational again. To be back here in a community he has real affection for. To visit with your alumni and coaching staff. To have already justified his high seed in this week's not unstiff competition. To, as they say, still be in it without the fat woman in the Viking hat having sung, so to speak. But of course, most of all, to have a chance to meet you gentlemen and have a look at the facilities here. Everything here is absolutely top slot from what he's seen.
There is a silence. DeLint shifts his back against the room's paneling and recenters his weight. My uncle beams and straightens a straight watchband. 62.5% of the room's faces are directed my way, pleasantly expectant. My chest bumps like a dryer with shoes in it. I compose what I project will be seen as a smile. I turn this way and that, slightly, sort of directing the expression to everyone in the room. There is a new silence. The yellow dean's eyebrows go circumflex. The two other deans look to the director of composition. The tennis coach has moved to stand at the broad window, feeling at the back of his crew cut. Uncle Charles strokes the forearm above his watch. Sharp curved palm shadows move slightly over the pine table's shine. The one head's shadow, a black moon.
Is Hal all right, Chuck?
Athletic Affairs asks.
Hal just seemed to, well, Grimace. Is he in pain? Are you in pain, son? Hal's right as rain, smiles my uncle, soothing the air with a casual hand. Just a bit of a, let's call it maybe a facial tick, slightly. At all the adrenaline of being here on your impressive campus. Justifying his seed so far without dropping a set. Receiving that official written offer of not only waivers, but a living allowance from Coach White here. On Pac-10 letterhead. Being ready in all probability to sign a national letter of intent right here and now, this very day. He's indicated to me. CT looks to me. His look horribly mild. I do the safe thing. Relaxing every muscle in my face. Emptying out all expression. I stare carefully into the Kekulean knot of the middle dean's necktie. My silent response to the expectant silence begins to affect the air of the room. The bits of dust and sport coat lint stirred around by the AC's vents, dancing jaggedly in the slanted plane of window light. The air over the table like the sparkling space just above a fresh poured seltzer. The coach, in a slight accent neither British nor Australian, is telling CT that the whole application interface process, while usually just a pleasant formality, is probably best accentuated by letting the applicant speak up for himself. Right and center deans have inclined together in soft conference, forming a kind of teepee of skin and hair. I presume it's probably facilitate that the tennis coach mistook for accentuate, though accelerate, while clunkier than facilitate, is from a phonetic perspective more sensible, as a mistake. The dean with the flat yellow face is leaned forward, his lips drawn back from his teeth in what I see as concern. His hands come together on the conference table surface. His own fingers look like they mate as my own 4X series dissolves and I hold tight to the sides of my chair. We need candidly to chat. Reason? Potential problems with my application, they and I, he is beginning to say. He makes a reference to candor and its value.
The issues my office faces with the application materials on file from you, Hal, involve some test scores.
He glances down at a colorful sheet of standardized scores in the trench his arms have made.
The admission staff is looking at standardized test scores from you that are, as I'm sure you know and can explain, are, shall we say, subnormal.
I'm to explain. It's clear that this really pretty sincere yellow dean at left is admissions. And surely the little aviarian figure at right is athletics then, because the facial creases of the shaggy middle dean are now pursed in a kind of distant affront, and I'm eating something that makes me really appreciate the presence of whatever I'm drinking along with it, look. That spells professionally academic reservations. An uncomplicated loyalty to standards, then, at center. My uncle looks to athletics as if puzzled. He shifts slightly in his chair. The incongruity between admissions, hand, and face color is almost wild.
Verbal scores that are just quite a bit closer to zero than we are comfortable with, as against a secondary school transcript from the institution where your mother and her brother are administrators.
Reading directly out of the sheaf inside his arm's lips.
But this past year, yes, has fallen off a bit. But by the word, I mean fallen off to outstanding from three previous years of, frankly, incredible.
Off the charts. Most institutions do not even have grades of A with multiple pluses after it, says the director of composition, his expression impossible to interpret.
This kind of, how shall I put it, incongruity,
admission says, his expression frank and concerned.
I've got to tell you, sends up a red flag of potential concern during the admissions process. We thus invite you to explain the appearance of incongruity, if not outright shenanigans.
Student says a tiny piping voice that's absurd coming out of a face this big.
Surely by incredible you mean very, very, very impressive, as opposed to literally, quote, incredible.
Surely, says CT, seeming to watch the coach at the window massaging the back of his neck. The huge window gives out on nothing more than dazzling sunlight and cracked earth with heat shimmers over it.
Then there is before us the matter of not the required 2, but 9 separate application essays, some of which of nearly monograph length, each without exception being different sheet. The adjective various evaluators used was, quote, stellar. Director of Composition. I made, in my assessment, deliberate use of lapidary and effete. But in areas and with titles I'm sure you recall quite well, Hal. Neoclassical assumptions in contemporary prescriptive grammar. The implications of post-Fourier transformations for a holographically mimetic cinema. The emergence of heroic stasis in broadcast entertainment. Montague grammar and the semantics of physical modality. A man who began to suspect he was made of glass. Tertiary symbolism in Justinian erotica. Now showing broad expanses of recessed gum. Suffice to say that there's some frank and candid concern about the recipient of these unfortunate test scores. Though perhaps explainable test scores, being these essays' sole individual author. I'm not sure Hal's sure just what's being implied here, my uncle says. The dean at center is fingering his lapels as he interprets distasteful computed data. What the university is saying here is that from a strictly academic point of view, there are admission problems that Hal needs to try to help us iron out. A matriculant's first role at the university is and must be as a student. We couldn't admit a student we have reason to suspect can't cut the mustard, no matter how much of an asset he might be on the field. Dean Sawyer means the court, of course, Chuck, athletic affair says, head severely cocked, so he's including the white person behind him in the address somehow. Not to mention ONAN CAA regulations and investigators always snuffling around for some sort of whiff of the smell of impropriety. The varsity tennis coach looks at his own watch. Assuming these board scores are accurate reflectors of true capacity in this case, academic affairs says, his high voice serious and sotto, still looking at the file before him as if it were a plate of something bad. I'll tell you right now, my opinion is it wouldn't be fair. It wouldn't be fair to the other applicants. Wouldn't be fair to the university community. He looks at me. And it'd be especially unfair to Hal himself. Admitting a boy we see as simply an athletic asset would amount to just using that boy. We're under myriad scrutiny to make sure we're not using anybody. Your board results, son, indicate that we could be accused of using you. Uncle Charles is asking Coach White to ask the Dean of Athletic Affairs whether the weather over scores would be as heavy if I were, say, a revenue-raising football prodigy. The familiar panic at feeling misperceived is rising, and my chest bumps and thuds. I expend energy on remaining utterly silent in my chair, empty, my two eyes, great, pale zeros. People have promised to get me through this. Uncle C.T., though, has the pinched look of the cornered. His voice takes on an odd timbre when he's cornered, as if he were shouting as he receded. Hal's grades at ETA, which is, I should stress, an academy, not simply a camp or factory, accredited by both the Commonwealth of Massachusetts and the North American Sports Academy Association, it's focused on the total needs of the player and student. Founded by a towering intellectual figure, whom I hardly need name here, and based by him on the rigorous Oxbridge Quadrivium Trivium curricular model. A school fully staffed and equipped by a fully certified staff should show that my nephew here can cut just about any Pac-10 mustard that needs cutting, and that, the lint is moving toward the tennis coach who is shaking his head, would be able to see a distinct flavor of minor sport prejudice about this whole thing, CT says, crossing and recrossing his legs as I listen, composed and staring. The room's carbonated silence is now hostile. I think it's time to let the actual applicant himself speak out on his own behalf, academic affairs says very quietly. This seems somehow impossible with you here, sir. Athletics smiles tiredly under a hand that massages the bridge of his nose.
Maybe you'd excuse us for a moment and wait outside, Chuck.
Coach White could accompany Mr. Tavis and his associate out to reception, the yellow dean says, smiling into my unfocused eyes.
Led to believe this had all been ironed out in advance from the... CT is saying, as he and Delint are shown to the door. The tennis coach extends a hypertrophied arm. Athletics says, we're all friends and colleagues here.
This is not working out.
It strikes me that exit signs would look to a native speaker of Latin like red-lit signs that say, he leaves. I would yield to the urge to bolt for the door ahead of them if I could know that bolting for the door is what the men in this room would see. Delint is murmuring something to the tennis coach. Sounds of keyboards, phone consoles as the door is briefly opened, then firmly shut. I am alone among administrative heads.
Offense intended to anyone,
Athletic Affairs is saying, his sport coat tan and his necktie insigniated in tiny print.
Beyond just physical abilities out there in play, which, believe me, we respect. Want, believe me.
Question about it, we wouldn't be so anxious to chat with you directly, see?
That we've known in processing several prior applications through Coach White's office that the Enfield School has operated, however impressively, by close relations of first your brother,
who I can still remember the way White's predecessor, Maury Clamkin, wooed that kid, so that Grade's objectivity can be all too easily called into question. By whomsoever's calling, NAAUP, ill-willed Pac-10 programs, ONANCAA.
The essays are old ones, yes, but they are mine.
De moi.
But they are, yes, old, not quite on the application's instructed subject of most meaningful educational experience ever. If I'd done you one from the last year, it would look to you like some sort of infant's random stabs on a keyboard, and to you, who use whomsoever as a subject. And in this new smaller company, the director of composition seems abruptly to have actuated, emerged as both the alpha of the pack here, and way more effeminate than he'd seemed at first, standing hip-shot with a hand on his waist, walking with a roll to his shoulders, jingling change as he pulls up his pants as he slides into the chair, still warm from CT's bottom, crossing his legs in a way that inclines him well into my personal space, so that I can see multiple eyebrow ticks and capillary webs and the oysters below his eyes, and smell fabric softener and the remains of a breath mint turned sour. A bright, solid, but very shy boy. We know about your being very shy. Kirk White's told us what your athletically built, if rather standoffish, younger instructor told him. The director says softly, cupping what I feel to be a hand over my sport coat's biceps. Surely not. Who simply needs to swallow hard and trust and tell his side of the story to these gentlemen, who bear no maliciousness, none at all,
but are doing our jobs and trying to look out for everyone's interests at the same time.
I can picture Delint and White sitting with their elbows on their knees in the defecatory posture of all athletes at rest, Delint staring at his huge thumbs, while CT in the reception area paces in a tight ellipse, speaking into his portable phone. I have been coached for this like a don before a RICO hearing. A neutral and effectless silence. The sort of all-defensive game Shtit used to have me play. The best defense. Let everything bounce off you. Do nothing. I tell you all you want and more, if the sounds I made could be what you hear. Athletics with his head out from under his wing.
To avoid admission procedures that could be seen as primarily athletics-oriented, it could be a mess, son.
Bill means the appearance, not necessarily the real, true facts of the matter, which you alone can fill in, says the director of composition.
The appearance of the high athletic ranking, the subnormal scores, the over-academic essays, the incredible grades vortexing out of what could be seen as a nepotistic situation.
The yellow dean has leaned so far forward that his tie is going to have a horizontal dent from the table edge. His face sallow and kindly and no shit whatever.
Look here, Mr. Incandenza. Hal, please, just explain to me why we couldn't be accused of using you, son. why nobody could come and say to us, why, look here, University of Arizona, here you are using a boy for just his body. A boy so shy and withdrawn he wouldn't speak up for himself. A jock with doctored minds and a store-bought application. The Brewster's angle light at the tabletop appears as a rose flush behind my closed lids. I cannot make myself understood. I am not just a jock, I say slowly, distinctly. My transcript for the last year might have been dickied a bit, maybe, but that was to get me over a rough spot.
The grades prior to that are de moi.
My eyes are closed. The room is silent. I cannot make myself understood now. I am speaking slowly and distinctly. Call it something I ate. It's funny what you don't recall. Our first home in the suburb of Weston, which I barely remember. My eldest brother, Oren, says he can remember being in the home's backyard with our mother in the early spring, helping the moms till some sort of garden out of the cold yard, March or early April. The garden's area was a rough rectangle laid out with popsicle sticks and twine. Oren was removing rocks and hard clods from the mom's path as she worked the rented rototiller, a wheelbarrow-shaped, gas-driven thing that roared and snorted and bucked and, he remembers, seemed to propel the moms rather than vice versa. The mom's very tall and having to stoop painfully to hold on, her feet leaving drunken prints in the tilled earth. He remembers that in the middle of the tilling, I came terracing out the door and into the backyard wearing some sort of fuzzy red poo wear, crying, holding out something he said was really unpleasant looking in my upturned palm. He says I was around 5 and crying and was vividly red in the cold spring air. I was saying something over and over. He couldn't make it out until our mother saw me and shut down the tiller, ears ringing, and came over to see what I was holding out. This turned out to have been a large patch of mold. Oren posits from some dark corner of the Weston home's basement, which was warm from the furnace and flooded every spring. The patch itself he describes as horrific, darkly green, glossy, vaguely hirsute, speckled with parasitic fungal points of yellow, orange, red. Worse, they could see that the patch looked oddly incomplete, gnawed on, and some of the nauseous stuff was smeared around my open mouth.
I ate this,
was what I was saying. I held the patch out to the moms, who had her contacts out for the dirty work, and at first, bending way down, saw only her crying child, hand out, proffering. And in that most maternal of reflexes, she, who feared and loathed more than anything spoilage and filth, reached to take whatever her baby held out, as in how many used heavy Kleenex, spit-back candies, wads of chewed-out gum, in how many theaters, airports, backseats, tournament lounges. O stood there, he says, hefting a cold clod, playing with the Velcro on his puffy coat, watching as the moms bent way down to me, hand reaching, her lowering face with its presbyopic squint, suddenly stopped, froze, beginning to ID what it was I held out, countenancing evidence of oral contact with same. He remembers her face as past describing, her outstretched hand still roto-trembling, hung in the air before mine.
I ate this,
I say. Pardon me? O says he can only remember saying something caustic as he limboed a crick out of his back. He says he must have felt a terrible impending anxiety. The moms refused ever even to go into the damp basement. I had stopped crying, he remembers, and simply stood there, the size and shape of a hydrant, in red PJs with attached feet, holding out the mold, seriously, like the report of some kind of audit. O says his memory diverges at this point, probably as a result of anxiety. In his first memory, the mom's path around the yard is a broad circle of hysteria.
God!
She calls out.
Help! My son ate this!
She yells in Oren's second and more fleshed-out recollection, yelling it over and over,
holding the speckled patch aloft in a pincer of fingers, running around and around the garden's rectangle, while O gaped at his first real sight of adult hysteria. Suburban neighbors' heads appeared in windows and over the fences, looking. O remembers me tripping over the garden's laid-out twine, getting up dirty, crying, trying to follow.
God, help! My son ate this! Help!
She kept yelling, running a tight pattern just inside the square of string, and my brother Oren remembers noting how even in hysterical trauma, her flight lines were plumb, her footprints Native American straight, her turns inside the ideogram of string, crisp and martial, crying,
my son ate this, help!
And lapping me twice before the memory recedes. My application's not bought, I am telling them, calling into the darkness of the red cave that opens out before closed eyes. I am not just a boy who plays tennis. I have an intricate history, experiences, and feelings. I'm complex. I read, I say. I study and read. I bet I've read everything you've read. Don't think I haven't. I consume libraries. I wear out spines and ROM drives. I do things like get in a taxi and say, the library, and step on it. My instincts concerning syntax and mechanics are better than your own, I can tell with due respect. But it transcends the mechanics. I'm not a machine. I feel and believe. I have opinions. Some of them are interesting. I could, if you'd let me, talk and talk. Let's talk about anything. I believe the influence of Kierkegaard on Camus is underestimated. I believe Denis Gabor may very well have been the Antichrist. I believe Hobbes is just Rousseau in a dark mirror. I believe, with Hegel, the transcendence is absorption. I could interface you guys right under the table, I say. I am not just a creatus, manufactured, conditioned, bred for a function. I open my eyes. Please, don't think I don't care. I look out. Directed my way is horror. I rise from the chair. I see jowls sagging, eyebrows high on trembling foreheads, cheeks bright white. The chair recedes below me. Sweet mother of Christ, the director says. I'm fine, I tell them, standing. From the yellow dean's expression, there's a brutal wind blowing from my direction. Academic's face has gone instantly old. Eight eyes have become blank disks that stare at whatever they see. Good God, whispers Athletics. Please don't worry, I say. I can explain. I soothe the air with a casual hand. Both my arms are pinioned from behind by the director of comp, who wrestles me roughly down, on me with all his weight. I taste floor. What's wrong? I say, nothing is wrong. It's all right, I'm here. The director is calling into my ear. Get help, cries a dean. My forehead is pressed into parquet I never knew could be so cold. I am arrested. I try to be perceived as limp and pliable. My face is mashed flat. Comp's weight makes it hard to breathe.
Try to listen,
I say very slowly, muffled by the floor. What in God's name are those? One dean cries shrilly. Those sounds! There are clicks of a phone console's buttons, shoes, heels moving, pivoting, a sheaf of flimsy pages falling.
God! Help!
The door's base opens at the left periphery. A wedge of halogen hall light, white sneakers, and a scuffed nun bush.
Let him up!
That's DeLint.
There is nothing wrong, I say slowly to the floor. I'm in here.
I'm raised by the crutches of my underarms, shaken toward what he must see as calm by a purple-faced director.
Get a grip, son.
DeLint at the big man's arm. Stop it.
I am not what you see and hear.
Distant sirens, a crude half-Nelson, forms at the door. A young Hispanic woman holds her palm against her mouth, looking. I'm not, I say. You have to love old-fashioned men's rooms. The citrus scent of deodorant discs in the long porcelain trough. The stalls with wooden doors and frames of cool marble. These thin sinks in rows. Basins supported by rickety alphabets of exposed plumbing. Mirrors over metal shelves. Behind all the voices, the slight sound of a ceaseless trickle. Inflated by echo against wet porcelain and a cold tile floor whose mosaic pattern looks almost Islamic at this close range. The disorder I've caused revolves all around. I've been half-dragged, still pinioned, through a loose mob of administrative people by the comp director, who appears to have thought variously that I am having a seizure, prying open my mouth to check for a throat clear of tongue, that I am somehow choking, a textbook Heimlich that left me whooping, that I am psychotically out of control, various postures and grips designed to transfer that control to him. While about us Royal DeLint, trying to restrain the director's restraint of me, the varsity tennis coach restraining DeLint, my mother's half-brother speaking in rapid combinations of polysyllables to the trio of deans, who variously gasp, wring hands, loosen neckties, waggle digits in CT's face, and make passes with sheafs of now pretty clearly superfluous application forms. I am rolled over supine on the geometric tile. I am concentrating docilely on the question why U.S. restrooms always appear to us as infirmaries for public distress, the place to regain control. My head is cradled in a knelt director's lap, which is soft, my face being swathed with dusty brown institutional paper towels he received from some hand out of the crowd overhead, staring with all the blankness I can summon into his jowls, small pucks. Worst at the blurred jawline, a scarring from long-ago acne. Uncle Charles, a truly unparalleled slinger of shit, is laying down an enfilade of same, trying to mollify men who seem way more in need of a good brow mopping than I. He's fine, he keeps saying. Look at him, calm as can be, lying there.
You didn't see what happened in there,
a hunched Dean responds through a face webbed with fingers. Excited is all he gets sometimes. An excitable kid. Impressed with...
But the sounds he made.
Undescribable.
Like an animal.
Sub-animalistic noises and sounds.
Nor let's not forget the gestures.
Have you ever gotten help for this boy, Dr. Tavis?
Like some sort of animal with something in its mouth.
This boy is damaged.
Like a stick of butter being hit with a mallet.
A writhing animal with a knife in its eye.
What were you possibly about, trying to enroll this... and his arms?
You didn't see it, Tavis. His arms were...
flailing. This sort of awful reaching, drumming wriggle. Waggling.
The group looking briefly at someone outside my sight, trying to demonstrate something. Like a time-lapse, a flutter of some sort of awful growth. Sounded most of all like a drowning goat. A goat drowning in something viscous. This...
strangled series of bleats and...
Yes, they waggled.
So, suddenly a bit of excited waggling's a crime now?
You, sir, are in trouble. You are in trouble!
His face, as if he was strangling, burning. I believe I've seen a vision of hell.
He has some trouble communicating. He's communicatively challenged. No one's denying that.
The boy needs care. Instead of caring for the boy, you send him here to enroll? Compete?
Al?
You have not, in your most dreadful fantasies, dreamt of the amount of trouble you have bought yourself, Doctor, so-called headmaster, educator.
We're given to understand this was all just a formality. You took him aback, is all.
Shy. And you, White, you sought to recruit him.
And terribly impressed and excited in there without us, his support system, who you asked to leave. Which, if you'd... I'd only seen him play. On court, he's gorgeous. Possibly a genius. We had no idea. The brother's in the bloody NFL, for God's sake. Here's a top player, we thought, with Southwest roots. His stats were off the chart. We watched him through the whole Whataburger last fall. Not a waggle or a noise. We were watching ballet out there, a mate remarked after. Damn right you were watching ballet out there, White. This boy is a balletic athlete. A player.
Some kind of athletic savant, then. Balletic compensation for deep troubles which you, sir, choose to disguise by muzzling the boy in there. An expensive pair of Brazilian espadrilles goes by on the left and enters a stall. And the espadrilles come around and face me. The urinal trickles behind the voice's small echoes.
Perhaps we'll just be on our way,
CT is saying. The integrity of my sleep has been forever compromised, sir.
Think you could pass off a damaged applicant, fabricate credentials, and shunt him through a kangaroo interview, and inject him into all the rigors of college life?
Hal here functions, you ass. Given a supportive situation, he's fine when he's by himself. Yes, he has some trouble with excitability and conversation. Did you once hear him try to deny that?
We witnessed something only marginally mammalian in there, sir.
Like hell, have a look. How's the excitable little guy doing down there, Aubrey? Does it look to you?
You, sir, are quite possibly ill. This affair is not concluded.
What ambulance? Don't you guys listen? I'm telling you, there's...
Hal? Hal? Dope him up? Seek to act as his mouthpiece? Muzzling, and now he lies there, catatonic, staring? A crackle of DeLint's knees. Hal?
Inflate this publicly in any distorted way. The Academy has distinguished alumni, litigators at council. Hal here is provably competent. Credentials out the bazoo, Bill. The boy reads like a vacuum. Digests things.
I simply lie there, listening, smelling the paper towel, watching an espadrille pivot.
There's more to life than sitting there interfacing. It might be a newsflash to you.
And who could not love that special and leonine roar of a public toilet? Not for nothing did Oren say that people outdoors down here just scuttle in vectors from air conditioning to air conditioning. The sun is a hammer. I can feel one side of my face start to cook. The blue sky is glossy and fat with heat. A few thin cirri sheared to blown strands like hair at the rims. The traffic is nothing like Boston. The stretcher is the special type, with restraining straps at the extremities. The same Aubrey DeLint I dismissed for years as a 2D martinet knelt gurneyside to squeeze my restrained hand and say, "Just hang in there, buckaroo," before moving back into the administrative fray at the ambulance's doors. It is a special ambulance, dispatched from I'd rather not dwell on where, with not only paramedics, but some kind of psychiatric MD on board. The medics lift gently and are handy with straps. The MD, his back up against the ambulance's side, has both hands up in dispassionate mediation between the deans and CT, who keeps stabbing skyward with his cellular's antenna as if it were a saber, outraged that I'm being needlessly ambulanced off to some emergency room against my will and interests. The issue whether the damaged even have interested wills is shallowly hashed out, as some sort of ultra mock fighter too high overhead to hear slices the sky from south to north. The MD has both hands up and is patting the air to signify dispassion. He has a big blue jaw. At the only other emergency room I've ever been in, almost exactly 1 year back, the psychiatric stretcher was wheeled in and then parked beside the waiting room chairs. These chairs were molded orange plastic. Three of them down the row were occupied by different people, all of whom were holding empty prescription bottles and perspiring freely. This would have been bad enough, but in the end chair, right up next to the strap-secured head of my stretcher, was a t-shirted woman with barnwood skin and a trucker's cap and a bad starboard list who began to tell me, lying there restrained and immobile, about how she had seemingly overnight suffered a sudden and anomalous gigantism in her right breast, which she referred to as a titty. She had an almost parodic Quebecois accent and described the titty's presenting history and possible diagnoses for almost 20 minutes before I was rolled away. The jet's movement and trail seemed incisionish, as if white meat behind the blue were exposed and widening in the wake of the blade. I once saw the word knife finger written on the steamed mirror of a non-public bathroom. I have become an infantophile.
I am forced to roll my closed eyes either up or to the side to keep the red cave from bursting into flames from the summit. The street's passing traffic is constant and seems to go hush, hush, hush. The sun, if your fluttering eye catches it even slightly, gives you the blue and red floaters a flashbulb gives you.
Why not? Why not? Why not not, then? If the best reasoning you can contrive is why not?
CT's voice receding with outrage. Only the gallant stabs of his antenna are now visible, just inside my sight's right frame. I will be conveyed to an emergency room of some kind, where I will be detained as long as I do not respond to questions. And then when I do respond to questions, I will be sedated. So it will be inversion of standard travel. The ambulance and ER. I'll make the journey first, then depart. I think very briefly of the late Cosgrove Watt. I think of the hypophalangeal grief therapist. I think of the moms alphabetizing cans of soup in the cabinet over the microwave. Of himself's umbrella hung by its handle from the edge of the mail table just inside the headmaster's house's foyer. The bad ankle hasn't ached once this whole year. I think of John N.R. Wayne, who would have won this year's Whataburger, standing watch in a mask as Donald Gately and I dig up my father's head. There's very little doubt that Wayne would have won. And Venus Williams owns a ranch outside Green Valley. She may well attend the 18s boys and girls finals. I will be out in plenty of time for tomorrow's semi. I trust Uncle Charles. Tonight's winner is almost sure to be Dimphna, 16, but with a birthday 2 weeks under the 15th of April deadline. And Dimphna will still be tired tomorrow at 08:30, while I, sedated, will have slept like a graven image. I have never before faced Dimphna in tournament play, nor played with the sonic balls the blind require. But I watched him barely dispatch Petropolis Khan in the round of 16, and I know he is mine. It will start in the ER, at the intake desk if CT's late in following the ambulance, or in the green-tiled room after the room with the invasive digital machines, or, given this special MD-supplied ambulance, maybe on the ride itself. Some blue-jawed MD scrubbed to an antiseptic glow, with his name sewn in cursive on his white coat's breast pocket and a quality desk-set pen. Wanting gurney-side Q&A, etiology, and diagnosis by Socratic method, ordered and point by point. There are, by the OED-6's count, 19 non-archaic synonyms for unresponsive, of which 9 are Latinate and 4 saxonic. I will play either Stice or Polyp in Sunday's final. Maybe in front of Venus Williams. They will be someone blue-collar and unlicensed, though, inevitably. A nurse's aide with quick-bit nails. A hospital security guy. A tired Cuban orderly who addresses me as Ju. Who will, looking down in the middle of some kind of bustled task, catch what he sees as my eye and ask,
"So, yo then, man. What's your story?"
Year of the Depend Adult Undergarment. Where was the woman who said she'd come? She said she would come. Her daddy thought she'd have come by now. He sat and thought. He was in the living room. When he started waiting, one window was full of yellow light and cast a shadow of light across the floor, and he was still sitting, waiting, as that shadow began to fade and was intersected by a brightening shadow from a different wall's window. There was an insect on one of the steel shelves that held his audio equipment. The insect kept going in and out of one of the holes on the girders that the shelves fit into. The insect was dark and had a shiny case. He kept looking over at it. Once or twice he started to get up to go over closer to look at it, but he was afraid that if he came closer and saw it closer, he would kill it. And he was afraid to kill it.
He did not use the phone to call the woman who'd promised to come, because if he tied up the line, and if it happened to be the time when maybe she was trying to call him, he was afraid she would hear the busy signal and think him disinterested and get angry and maybe take what she'd promised him somewhere else. She had promised to get him a fifth of a kilogram of marijuana, 200 grams of unusually good marijuana, for $1,250 US. He had tried to stop smoking marijuana maybe 70 or 80 times before this woman knew him. She did not know he had tried to stop. He always lasted a week or 2 weeks or maybe 10 days, and then he'd think and decide to have some in his home one more last time. One last final time he'd search out someone new, someone he hadn't already told that he had to stop smoking dope, and please, under no circumstances should they procure him any dope. It had to be a third party, because he told every dealer he knew to cut him off. And the third party had to be someone all new, because each time he got some, he knew this time had to be the last time, and so told them, asked them, as a favor, never to get him any more, ever. And he never asked a person again once he told them this, because he was proud, and also kind, and wouldn't put anyone in that kind of contradictory position. Also, he considered himself creepy when it came to dope, and he was afraid that others would see that he was creepy about it as well. He sat and thought and waited in an uneven X of light through two different windows. Once or twice, he looked at the phone. The insect had disappeared back into the hole in the steel girder the shelf fit into. She'd promised to come at one certain time, and it was past that time. Finally, he gave in and called her number, using just audio, and it rang several times, and he was afraid of how much time he was taking tying up the line, and he got her audio answering device. The message had a snatch of ironic pop music and her voice and a male voice together saying, "We'll call you back," and the "we" made them sound like a couple. The man was a handsome black man who was in law school. She designed sets, and he didn't leave a message because he didn't want her to know how much he felt like he needed it. He had been very casual about the whole thing. She said she knew a guy just over the river in Alston who sold high-resin dope in moderate bulk, and he'd yawned and said, "Well, maybe. Well, hey, why not? Sure. Special occasion. I haven't bought any in I don't know how long." She said he lived in a trailer and had a hair lip and kept snakes and had no phone and was basically just not what you'd call a pleasant or attractive person at all. But the guy in Alston frequently sold dope to theater people in Cambridge and had a devoted following. He said he was trying to even remember when was the last time he'd bought any. It had been so long. He said he guessed he'd have her get a decent amount. He said he'd had some friends call him in the recent past and ask if he could get them some. He had this thing where he'd frequently say he was getting dope mostly for friends. Then if the woman didn't have it when she said she'd have it for him, and he became anxious about it, he could tell the woman that it was his friends who were becoming anxious. And he was sorry to bother the woman about something so casual, but his friends were anxious and bothering him about it, and he just wanted to know what he could maybe tell them. He was caught in the middle, that's how he would represent it. He could say his friends had given him their money and were now anxious and exerting pressure, calling and bothering him. This tactic was not possible with this one, who'd said she'd come with it because he hadn't yet given her the $1,250. She would not let him. She was well off. Her family was well off, she'd said, to explain how her condominium was as nice as it was when she worked designing sets for a Cambridge theater company that seemed to do only German plays. Dark, smeary sets. She didn't care much about the money. She said she'd cover the cost herself when she got out to the Alston Spur to see whether the guy was at home in the trailer, as she was certain he would be this particular afternoon, and he could just reimburse her when she brought it to him. This arrangement, very casual, made him anxious. So he'd been even more casual and said, "Sure, fine,
whatever.
Thinking back, he was sure he'd said, whatever. Which in retrospect worried him because it might have sounded as if he didn't care at all. Not at all. So little that it wouldn't matter if she forgot to get it or call. And once he'd made the decision to have marijuana in his home one more time, it mattered a lot. It mattered a lot. He'd been too casual with the woman. He should have made her take $1,250 from him up front, claiming politeness, claiming he didn't want to inconvenience her financially over something so trivial and casual. Money created a sense of obligation, and he should have wanted the woman to feel obligated to do what she'd said. Once what she'd said she'd do had set him off inside. Once he'd been set off inside, it mattered so much that he was somehow afraid to show how much it mattered. Once he had asked her to get it, he was committed to several courses of action. The insect on the shelf was back. It didn't seem to do anything. It just came out of the hole, in the girder, onto the edge of the steel shelf and sat there. After a while, it would disappear back into the hole in the girder. And he was pretty sure it didn't do anything in there, either. He felt similar to the insect inside the girder his shelf was connected to, but was not sure just how he was similar. Once he decided to own marijuana one more last time, he was committed to several courses of action. He had to motor in to the agency and say that there was an emergency and that he was posting an e-note on a colleague's TP asking her to cover his calls for the rest of the week because he'd be out of contact for several days due to this emergency. He had to put an audio message on his answering device saying that starting that afternoon he was going to be unreachable for several days. He had to clean his bedroom because once he had dope, he would not leave his bedroom except to go to the refrigerator and the bathroom, and even then, the trips would be very quick. He had to throw out all his beer and liquor, because if he drank alcohol and smoked dope at the same time, he would get dizzy and ill. And if he had alcohol in the house, he could not be relied on not to drink it once he started smoking dope. He'd had to do some shopping. He'd had to lay in supplies. Now just one of the insect's antennae was protruding from the hole in the girder. It protruded, but it did not move. He had had to buy soda, Oreos, bread, sandwich meat, mayonnaise, tomatoes, M&Ms, almost home cookies, ice cream, a Pepperidge Farm frozen chocolate cake, and 4 cans of canned chocolate frosting to be eaten with a large spoon. He had to log an order to rent film cartridges from the Interlace Entertainment outlet. He'd had to buy antacids for the discomfort that eating all he would eat would cause him late at night. He'd had to buy a new bong because each time he finished what simply had to be his last bulk quantity of marijuana, he decided that that was it. He was through. He didn't even like it anymore. This was it. No more hiding. No more imposing on his colleagues and putting different messages on his answering device, and moving his car away from his condominium and closing his windows and curtains and blinds, and living in quick vectors between his bedroom's interlaced teleputers films and his refrigerator and his toilet. And he would take the bong he'd used and throw it away, wrapped in several plastic shopping bags. His refrigerator made its own ice in little cloudy crescent blocks, and he loved it. When he had dope in his home, he always drank a great deal of cold soda and ice water. His tongue almost swelled at just the thought. He looked at the phone and the clock. He looked at the windows, but not at the foliage and blacktop driveway beyond the windows. He had already vacuumed his Venetian blinds and curtains. Everything was ready to be shut down. Once the woman who said she'd come had come, he would shut the whole system down. It occurred to him that he would disappear into a hole in a girder inside him that supported something else inside him. He was unsure what the thing inside him was, and was unprepared to commit himself to the course of action that would be required to explore the question. It was now almost 3 hours past the time when the woman had said she would come. A counselor, Randy, with an eye, with a mustache like a Mountie, I told him in the outpatient treatment program he'd gone through 2 years ago that he seemed insufficiently committed to the course of action that would be required to remove substances from his lifestyle. He'd had to buy a new bong at Bogart's in Porter Square, Cambridge, because whenever he finished the last of the substances on hand, he always threw out all his bongs and pipes, screens and tubes and rolling papers and roach clips, lighters and Visine and Pepto-Bismol, and cookies and frosting to eliminate all future temptation. He always felt a sense of optimism and firm resolve after he'd discarded the materials. He'd bought the new bong and laid in fresh supplies this morning, getting back home with everything well before the woman had said she would come. He thought of the new bong, a new little packet of round brass screens in the Bogart's bag on his kitchen table in the sunlit kitchen, and could not remember what color the new bong was. The last one had been orange. The one before that, a dusky rose color that had turned muddy at the bottom from resin in just 4 days. He could not remember the color of this new last and final bong. He considered getting up to check the color of the bong he'd be using, but decided that obsessive checking and convulsive movements could compromise the atmosphere of casual calm he needed to maintain while he waited, protruding, but not moving, for the woman he'd met at a design session for his agency's small campaign for her small theater company's new Vedicant Festival, while he waited for this woman, with whom he'd had intercourse twice, to honor her casual promise. He tried to decide whether the woman was pretty. Another thing he'd laid in when he'd committed himself to one last marijuana vacation was petroleum jelly. When he smoked marijuana, he tended to masturbate a great deal, whether or not there were opportunities for intercourse. Opting when he smoked for masturbation over intercourse, and the petroleum jelly kept him from returning to normal function, all tender and sore. He was also hesitant to get up and check the color of his bong because he would have to pass right by the telephone console to get to the kitchen, and he didn't want to be tempted to call the woman who said she would come again because he felt creepy about bothering her about something he'd represented as so casual, and was afraid that several audio hang-ups on her answering device would look even creepier. And also he felt anxious about tying up the line at just the moment when she called, as she certainly would. He decided to get call waiting added to his audiophone service for a nominal extra charge. Then remembered that since this was positively the last time he would or even could indulge what Randy with an I had called an addiction every bit as rapacious as pure alcoholism, there would be no real need for call waiting, since a situation like the present one could never arise again. This line of thinking almost caused him to become angry. To ensure the composure with which he sat waiting in light in his chair, he focused his senses on his surroundings. No part of the insect he'd seen was now visible. The clicks of his portable clock were really composed of three smaller clicks, signifying, he supposed, preparation, movement, and readjustment. He began to grow disgusted with himself for waiting so anxiously for the promised arrival of something that had stopped being fun anyway. He didn't even know why he liked it anymore. It made his mouth dry and his eyes dry and red and his face sag, and he hated it when his face sagged. It was as if all the integrity of all the muscles in his face was eroded by marijuana. And he got terribly self-conscious about the fact that his face was sagging and had long ago forbidden himself to smoke dope around anyone else. He didn't even know what its draw was anymore. He couldn't even be around anyone else if he'd smoked marijuana that same day. It made him so self-conscious. And the dope often gave him a painful case of pleurisy if he smoked it for more than 2 straight days of heavy, continuous smoking in front of the interlaced viewer in his bedroom. It made his thoughts jut out crazily in jagged directions and made him stare raptly like an unbright child at entertainment cartridges. When he laid in film cartridges for a vacation with marijuana, he favored cartridges in which a lot of things blew up and crashed into each other, which he was sure an unpleasant fact specialist like Randy would point out had implications that were not good. He pulled his necktie down smooth while he gathered his intellect, will, self-knowledge, and conviction, and determined that when this latest woman came, as she surely would, this would simply be his very last marijuana debauch. He'd simply smoke so much, so fast, that it would be so unpleasant, and the memory of it so repulsive, that once he'd consumed it and gotten it out of his home and his life as quickly as possible, he would never want to do it again. He would make it his business to create a really bad set of debauched associations with the stuff in his memory. The dope scared him. It made him afraid. It wasn't that he was afraid of the dope, it was that smoking it made him afraid of everything else. It had long since stopped being a release, or relief, or fun. This last time, he would smoke the whole 200 grams, 120 grams cleaned, destemmed, in 4 days, over an ounce a day, all in tight, heavy, economical one-hitters off a quality virgin bong, an incredible, insane amount per day. He'd make it a mission, treating it like a penance and behavior modification regimen all at once. He'd smoke his way through 30 high-grade grams a day, starting the moment he woke up and used ice water to detach his tongue from the roof of his mouth and took an antacid, averaging out to 200 or 300 heavy bong hits per day. An insane and deliberately unpleasant amount, and he'd make it a mission to smoke it continuously, even though if the marijuana was as good as the woman claimed, he'd do 5 hits and then not want to take the trouble to load and one hit anymore for at least an hour. But he would force himself to do it anyway. He would smoke it all, even if he didn't want it. Even if it started to make him dizzy and ill, he would use discipline and persistence and will and make the whole experience so unpleasant, so debased and debauched and unpleasant that his behavior would be henceforward modified. He'd never even want to do it again because the memory of the insane 4 days to come would be so firmly, terribly emblazoned in his memory. He'd cure himself by excess. He predicted that the woman, when she came, might want to smoke some of the 200 grams with him. Hang out, hole up, listen to some of his impressive collection of Tito Puente recordings, and probably have intercourse. He had never once had actual intercourse on marijuana. Frankly, the idea repelled him. 2 dry mouths bumping at each other, trying to kiss. His self-conscious thoughts twisting around on themselves like a snake on a stick, while he bucked and snorted dryly above her, his swollen eyes red and his face sagging so that its slack folds may be touched limply, the folds of her own loose sagging face as it sloshed back and forth on his pillow, its mouth working dryly. The thought was repellent. He decided he'd have her toss him what she'd promised to bring, and then would from a distance toss back to her the $1,250 U.S. in large bills and tell her not to let the door hit her on the butt on the way out. He'd say ass instead of butt. He'd be so rude and unpleasant to her that the memory of his lack of basic decency and of her tight, offended face would be a further disincentive ever in the future to risk calling her and repeating the course of action he had now committed himself to. He had never been so anxious for the arrival of a woman he did not want to see. He remembered clearly the last woman he'd involved in his trying just one more vacation with dope and drawn blinds. The last woman had been something called an appropriation artist, which seemed to mean that she copied and embellished other art and then sold it through a prestigious Marlborough Street gallery. She had an artistic manifesto that involved radical feminist themes. He'd let her give him one of her smaller paintings, which covered half the wall over his bed, and was of a famous film actress whose name he always had a hard time recalling, and a less famous film actor. The two of them entwined in a scene from a well-known old film, a romantic scene, an embrace, copied from a film history textbook, and much enlarged and made stilted, and with obscenities scrawled all over it in bright red letters.
One.
The last woman had been sexy, but not pretty. As the woman he now didn't want to see, but was still waiting anxiously for, was pretty in a faded, withered Cambridge way that made her seem pretty, but not sexy. The appropriation artist had been led to believe that he was a former speed addict. Intravenous addiction to methamphetamine hydrochloride is what he remembered telling that one. He had even described the awful taste of hydrochloride in the addict's mouth immediately after injection. He had researched the subject carefully. She had been further led to believe that marijuana kept him from using the drug with which he really had a problem. And so that if he seemed anxious to get some once she'd offered to get him some, it was only because he was heroically holding out against much darker, deeper, more addictive urges, and he needed her to help him. He couldn't quite remember when or how she'd been given all these impressions. He had not sat down and outright bold-faced lied to her. It had been more of an impression he'd conveyed and nurtured and allowed to gather its own life and force. The insect was now entirely visible. It was on the shelf that held his digital equalizer. The insect might never actually have retreated all the way back into the hole in the shelf's girder. What looked like its reemergence might just have been a change in his attention, or the two windows' light, or the visual context of his surroundings. The girder protruded from the wall and was a triangle of dull steel with holes for shelves to fit into. The metal shelves that held his audio equipment were painted a dark industrial green and were originally made for holding canned goods. They were designed to be extra kitchen shelves. The insect sat inside its dark, shiny case with an immobility that seemed like the gathering of a force. It sat like the hull of a vehicle from which the engine had been, for the moment, removed. It was dark and had a shiny case and antennae that protruded but did not move. He had to use a bathroom. His last piece of contact from the appropriation artist with whom he had had intercourse, and who during intercourse had sprayed some sort of perfume up into the air from a mister she held in her left hand as she lay beneath him, making a wide variety of sounds and spraying perfume up into the air, so that he felt the cold mist of it settling on his back and shoulders and was chilled and repelled. His last piece of contact after he'd gone into hiding with the marijuana she'd gotten for him had been a card she'd mailed that was a pastiche photo of a doormat of coarse green plastic grass with "Welcome" on it. And next to it, a flattering publicity photo of the appropriation artist from her Back Bay gallery. And between them, an unequal sign, which was an equal sign with a diagonal slash across it, and also an obscenity he had assumed was directed at him, majusculed in red grease pencil along the bottom, with multiple exclamation points. She had been offended, because he had seen her every day for 10 days. Then, when she'd finally obtained 50 grams of genetically enhanced hydroponic marijuana for him, he had said that she'd saved his life. And he was grateful. And the friends for whom he'd promised to get some were grateful. And she had to go right now because he had an appointment and had to take off, but that he would doubtless be calling her later that day. And they shared a moist kiss. And she had said she could feel his heart pounding right through his suit coat. And she had driven away in her rusty, unmuffled car. And he had gone and moved his own car to an underground garage several blocks away, and had run back and drawn the clean blinds and curtains and changed the audio message on his answering device to one that described an emergency departure from town, and had drawn and locked his bedroom blinds and had taken the new rose-colored bong out of its Bogart's bag and was not seen for 3 days, and ignored over 24 audio messages and protocols and e-notes expressing concern over his message's emergency, and had never contacted her again. He had hoped she would assume he had succumbed again to methamphetamine hydrochloride, and was sparing her the agony of his descent back into the hell of chemical dependence. What it really was that he had again decided those 50 grams of resin-soaked dope, which had been so potent that on the second day it had given him an anxiety attack so paralyzing that he had gone to the bathroom in a Tufts University commemorative ceramic stein to avoid leaving his bedroom, represented his very last debauch ever with dope, and that he had to cut himself off from all possible future sources of temptation and supply. And this surely included the appropriation artist, who would come with the stuff at precisely the time she'd promised, he recalled. From the street outside came the sound of a dumpster being emptied into an EWD land barge. His shame at what she might, on the other hand, perceive as his slimy, phallocentric conduct toward her made it easier for him to avoid her as well. Though not shame, really. More like being uncomfortable at the thought of it. He had had to launder his bedding twice to get the smell of the perfume out. He went into the bathroom to use the bathroom, making it a point to look neither at the insect visible on the shelf to his left, nor at the telephone console on its lacquer workstation to the right. He was committed to touching neither. Where was the woman who had said she'd come? The new bong in the Bogart's bag was orange, meaning he might have misremembered the bong before it as orange. It was a rich, autumnal orange that lightened to more of a citrus orange when its plastic cylinder was held up to the late afternoon light of the window over the kitchen sink. The metal of its stem and bowl was rough, stainless steel, the kind with a grain, unpretty and all business. The bong was half a meter tall, and had a weighted base covered in soft, false suede. Its orange plastic was thick, and the carb on the side opposite the stem had been raggedly cut so that rough shards of plastic protruded from the little hole, and it might well hurt his thumb when he smoked, which he decided to consider just part of the penance he would undertake after the woman had come and gone. He left the door to the bathroom open so that he would be sure to hear the telephone when it sounded, or the buzzer to the front doors of his condominium complex when it sounded. In the bathroom, his throat suddenly closed, and he wept hard for 2 or 3 seconds before the weeping stopped abruptly, and he could not get it to start again. It was now over 4 hours since the time the woman had casually committed to come. He was in the bathroom, or in his chair near the window, or near his telephone console, and the insect, and the window that had admitted a strange rectangular bar of light, when he began to wait. The light through this window was coming at an angle more and more oblique. Its shadow had become a parallelogram. The light through the southwest window was straight and reddening. He had thought he needed to use the bathroom, but was unable to. He tried putting a whole stack of film cartridges into the dock of the disk drive and then turning on the huge teleputer in his bedroom. He could see the piece of appropriation art in the mirror above the teepee. He lowered the volume all the way and pointed the remote device at the teepee like some sort of weapon. He sat on the edge of his bed with his elbows on his knees and scanned the stack of cartridges. Each cartridge in the dock dropped on command and began to engage the drive with an insectile click and whir, and he scanned it. But he was unable to distract himself with the TP because he was unable to stay with any one entertainment cartridge for more than a few seconds. The moment he recognized what exactly was on one cartridge, he had a strong anxious feeling that there was something more entertaining on another cartridge and that he was potentially missing it. He realized that he would have plenty of time to enjoy all the cartridges, and realized intellectually that the feeling of deprived panic over missing something made no sense. The viewer hung on the wall, half again as large as the piece of feminist art. He scanned cartridges for some time. The telephone console sounded during this interval of anxious scanning. He was up and moving back out toward it before the first ring was completed, flooded with either excitement or relief, the TP's remote device still in his hand, but it was only a friend and colleague calling. And when he heard the voice that was not the woman who had promised to bring what he'd committed the next several days to banishing from his life forever, he was almost sick with disappointment. with a great deal of mistaken adrenaline now shining and ringing in his system, and he got off the line with the colleague to clear the line and keep it available for the woman so fast that he was sure his colleague perceived him as either angry with him or just plain rude. He was further upset at the thought that his answering the telephone this late in the day did not jibe with the emergency message about being unreachable that would be on his answering device if the colleague called back after the woman had come and gone and he'd shut the whole system of his life down, and he was standing over the telephone console trying to decide whether the risk of the colleague or someone else from the agency calling back was sufficient to justify changing the audio message on the answering device to describe an emergency departure this evening instead of this afternoon. But he decided he felt that since the woman had definitely committed to coming, his leaving the message unchanged would be a gesture of fidelity to her commitment and might somehow, in some oblique way, strengthen that commitment. The EWD land barge was emptying dumpsters all up and down the street. He returned to his chair near the window. The disk drive and TP viewer were still on in his bedroom, and he could see through the angle of the bedroom's doorway the lights from the high-definition screen blink and shift from one primary color to another in the dim room. And for a while he killed time casually by trying to imagine what entertaining scenes on the unwatched viewer the changing colors and intensities might signify. The chair faced the room instead of the window. Reading while waiting for marijuana was out of the question. He considered masturbating, but did not. He didn't reject the idea so much as not react to it and watch as it floated away. He thought very broadly of desires and ideas being watched, but not acted upon. He thought of impulses being starved of expression and drying out and floating dryly away, and felt on some level that this had something to do with him and his circumstances. And what if this grueling final debauch he committed himself to didn't somehow resolve the problem, would surely have to be called his problem. But he could not even begin to try to see how the image of desiccated impulses floating dryly related to either him or the insect, which had retreated back into its hole in the angled girder, because at this precise time, his telephone and his intercom to the front door's buzzer both sounded at the same time. Both loud and tortured and so abrupt they sounded yanked through a very small hole into the great balloon of colored silence he sat in, waiting. And he moved first toward the telephone console, then over toward his intercom module, then convulsively back toward the sounding phone, and then tried somehow to move toward both at once, finally, so that he stood splay-legged, arms wildly out as if something's been flung, splayed, entombed between the two sounds, without a thought in his head. The 1st of April, year of the Tux Medicated Pad. All I know is my dad said to come here.
Come right in. You'll see a chair to your immediate left.
So, I'm here.
That's just fine. 7-Up? Maybe some lemon soda?
I guess not, thanks. I'm just here is all. And I'm kind of wondering why my dad sent me down, you know? Your door there doesn't have anything on it, and I was just at the dentist last week, and so I'm wondering why I'm here exactly is all. That's why I'm not sitting down yet.
You're how old, Hal? 14?
I'll be 11 in June. Are you a dentist? Is this like a dental consult?
You're here to converse.
Converse?
Yes. Pardon me while I key in this age correction. Your father had listed you as 14 for some reason.
Converse as in with you?
You're here to converse with me, Hal, yes. I'm almost going to have to implore you to have some lemon soda. Your mouth is making those dry, sticky, inadequate saliva sounds.
Dr. Zagarelli says that's one reason for all the caries, is that I have low salivary output.
Those dry, sticky, saliva-less sounds which can be death to a good conversation.
But I rode my bike all the way up here against the wind just to converse with you? Is the conversation supposed to start with me asking why?
I'll begin by asking if you know the meaning of implore, Hal.
Probably. I'll go ahead and take a 7-up then, if you're going to implore.
I'll ask you again whether you know implore, young sir.
Young sir?
You're wearing that bow tie, after all. Isn't that rather an invitation to a young sir?
Implore is a regular verb, transitive. To call upon or for in supplication. To pray to or for earnestly. To beseech, to entreat. Weak synonym, urge. Strong synonym, beg. Etymology unmixed.
From Latin, implorare. Im, meaning in. Plorare, meaning in this context, to cry aloud.
OED, condensed volume 6, page 1387, column 12, and a little bit of 13.
Good Lord. She didn't exaggerate, did she?
I tend to get beat up sometimes at the academy for stuff like that. Does this bear on why I'm here? That I'm a continentally ranked junior tennis player who can also recite great chunks of the dictionary, verbatim, at will, and tends to get beat up, and wears a bow tie? Are you like a specialist for gifted kids? Does this mean they think I'm gifted?
Psst. Here you are, drink up.
Thanks.
You were thirsty.
So then if I sit down, you'll fill me in?
Professional conversationalist knows his mucous membranes, after all.
I might have to burp a little bit in a second from the soda. I'm alerting you ahead of time.
Hal, you are here because I am a professional conversationalist. And your father has made an appointment with me for you to converse.
Oh, excuse me. Tap, 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 tap. Tap, 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 tap. You're a professional conversationalist.
I am, yes, as I believe I just stated. A professional conversationalist.
Don't start looking at your watch as if I'm taking up valuable time of yours. If himself made the appointment and paid for it, the time's supposed to be mine, right? Not yours. And then, but what's that supposed to mean, professional conversationalist? A conversationalist is just one who converses much. You actually charge a fee to converse much?
A conversationalist is also one who, I'm sure you'll recall, excels in conversation.
That's Webster 7th. It's not the OED.
Tap, tap.
I'm an OED man, doctor, if that's what you are. Are you a doctor? Do you have a doctorate? Most people like to put their diplomas up, I notice, if they have credentials. And Webster 7th isn't even up to date. Webster's 8th amends to one who converses with much enthusiasm.
Another 7-up?
Is himself still having this hallucination I never speak? Is that why he put the moms up to having me bike up here? Himself is my dad. We call him himself. As in, quote, the man himself. As it were, we call my mother the moms. My brother coined the term. I understand this isn't unusual. I understand most more or less normal families address each other internally by means of pet names and terms and monikers. Don't even think about asking me what my little internal moniker is. Tap, tap, tap. But himself hallucinates sometimes lately. You ought to be apprised, was the thrust. I'm wondering why the moms let him send me pedaling up here, uphill against the wind, when I've got a challenge match at 3 to converse with an enthusiast with a blank door and no diplomas anywhere in view.
I, in my small way, would like to think it had as much to do with me as with you, that my reputation preceded me.
Isn't that usually a pejorative clause?
I am wonderful fun to talk to. I'm a consummate professional. People leave my parlor in states. You are here. It's conversation time. Shall we discuss Byzantine erotica?
How did you know I was interested in Byzantine erotica?
You seem persistently to confuse me with someone who merely hangs out a shingle with the word conversationalist on it.
And this operation with a fly-by-night one, strung together with chewing gum and twine. You think I have no support staff? Researchers at my beck? You think we don't delve full-born to the psyches of those for whom we've made appointments to converse? You don't think this fully accredited, limited partnership would have an interest in obtaining data on what informs and stimulates our conversees? I know only one person who'd ever use full bore in casual conversation. There is nothing casual about a professional conversationalist and staff. We delve. We obtain. And then some, young sir. Okay. Alexandrian or Constantinian? You think we haven't thoroughly researched your own connection with the whole current intra-provincial crisis in southern Quebec? What intra-provincial crisis in southern Quebec? I thought you wanted to talk racy mosaics. This is an upscale district of a vital North American metropolis, Hal. Standards here are upscale and high. A professional conversationalist flat out full-bore delves. Do you for one moment think that a professional plier of the trade of conversation would fail to probe, beak deep into your family's sordid liaison with the pan-Canadian resistance's notorious Monsieur Duplessis and his malevolent but allegedly irresistible amanuensis, cum operative, Luria P? Listen, are you okay? Do you? I'm 10 for Pete's sake. I think maybe your appointment calendar squares got juggled. I'm the potentially gifted 10-year-old tennis and lexical prodigy whose mom's a continental mover and shaker in the prescriptive grammar academic world, and whose dad's a towering figure in optical and avant-garde film circles, and single-handedly founded the Enfield Tennis Academy but drinks wild turkey at like 5 a.m. and pitches over sideways during dawn drills on the court some days, and some days presents with delusions about people's mouths moving but nothing coming out. I'm not even up to J yet in the condensed OED, much less Quebec or malevolent Luria's. Of the fact that photos of the aforementioned liaison being leaked to Der Spiegel resulted in the bizarre deaths of both an Ottawan paparazzo and a Bavarian international affairs editor, of an alpenstock through the abdomen and an ill-swallowed cocktail onion, respectively. I just finished Jew's ear. I'm just starting on Jew's harp. And the general theory of oral liars. I've never even skied. That you could dare to imagine we'd fail conversationally to countenance certain weekly, shall we say, maternal assignations with a certain unnamed bisexual bassoonist in the Albertan Secret Guard's tactical bands unit? Gee, is that the exit over there I see? That your blithe inattention to your own dear grammatical mother's cavortings with not one, not two, but over 30 Near Eastern medical attachés, would it be rude to tell you your mustache is askew? That her introduction of esoteric mnemonic steroids, stereochemically not dissimilar to your father's own daily hypodermic megavitamin supplement, derived from a certain organic testosterone regeneration compound, distilled by the Hevero shaman of the South Central LA Basin into your innocent-looking bowl of morning Ralston. As a matter of fact, I'll go ahead and tell you, your whole face is kind of running, sort of. If you want to check, your nose is pointing at your lap. That your quote-unquote complimentary Dunlop wide-body tennis rackets, super-secret formulaic composition materials of high modulus, graphite-reinforced, polycarbonate, polybutylene resin, are organochemically identical, I say again, identical, to the gyroscopic balance sensor and the mise-en-scene appropriation card and priapistic entertainment cartridge implanted in your very own towering father's anaplastic cerebrum after his cruel series of detoxifications and convolution smoothings and gastrectomy and prostatectomy and pancreatectomy and phallectomy? Tap, tap. Could possibly escape the combined investigation attention of... And it strikes me I've definitely seen that Argyle sweater vest before. That's himself's special Interdependence Day celebratory dinner Argyle sweater vest that he makes a point of never having cleaned. I know those stains. I was there for that clot of veal marsala right there. Is this whole appointment a date-connected thing? Is this April Fool's Dad? Or do I need to call the moms and CT?
It requires only daily evidence that you speak, that you recognize the occasional vista beyond your own generous mondragonoid nose's fleshy tip.
You rented a whole office and face for this? But leave your old unmistakable sweater vest on? And how'd you even get down here before me? With the mercury up on blocks after you... Did you fool CT into giving you the keys to a functional car?
Who used to pray daily for the day his own dear late father would sit, cough, open that bloody tissue of the Tucson citizen, and not turn that newspaper into the room's fifth wall? And who, after all this light and noise, has apparently spawned the same silence? Who's lived his whole ruddy, bloody, cruddy life in five-walled rooms?
Dad, I've got a duly scheduled challenge match with Shocked in 12 minutes. Wind at my back downhill or no. I've got this oral lyrologist who's going to be outside Brighton Best Savings, wearing a pre-designated necktie at straight up 5. I have to mow his lawn for a month for this interview. I can't just sit here watching you think I'm mute while your fake nose points at the floor. And are you hearing me talking, Dad? It speaks. It accepts soda. And defines implore and converses with you.
Praying for just one conversation. Amateur or no, that does not end in terror. That does not end like all the others. You staring, me swallowing. Son. Son.
The 9th of May, year of the Depend Adult Undergarment. Another way fathers impact sons is that sons, once their voices have changed in puberty, invariably answer the telephone with the same locutions and intonations as their fathers. This holds true regardless of whether the fathers are still alive. Because he left his dormitory room before 0600 for dawn drills, and often didn't get back there until after supper, packing his book bag and knapsack and gear bag for the whole day, together with selecting his best strung rackets, it all took Hal some time. Plus, he usually collected and packed and selected in the dark, and with stealth, because his brother Mario was usually still asleep in the other bed. Mario didn't drill, and couldn't play, and needed all the sleep he could get. Hal held his complimentary gear bag and was putting different pairs of sweats to his face, trying to find the cleanest pair by smell, when the telephone console sounded. Mario thrashed and sat up in bed, a small, hunched shape with a big head against the gray light of the window. Hal got to the console on the second ring and had the transparent phone's antenna out by the third. His way of answering the phone sounded like, yellow?
I want to tell you, the voice on the phone said. My head is filled with things to say.
Hal held three pairs of ETA sweatpants in the hand that didn't hold the phone. He saw his older brother succumb to gravity and fall back limp against the pillows. Mario often sat up and fell back, still asleep.
I don't mind, Hal said softly. I could wait forever.
That's what you think, the voice said. The connection was cut. It had been Orin.
Hey, Hal.
The light in the room was a creepy gray, a kind of non-light. Hal could hear Brandt laughing at something Kenkel had said, off down the hall, on the clank of their janitorial buckets. The person on the phone had been O.
Hey, Hal.
Mario was awake. It took four pillows to support Mario's oversized skull. His voice came from the tangled bedding.
Is it still dark out, or is it me?
Go back to sleep. It isn't even 6.
Hal put the good leg into the sweatpants first.
Who was it?
Shoving three coverless Dunlop wide bodies into the gear bag and zipping the bag partway up so the handles had room to stick out. Carrying all three bags back over to the console to deactivate the ringer on the phone, he said,
No one you know, I don't think.
Year of the Depend Adult Undergarment. Though only one half ethnic Arab and a Canadian by birth and residence, the medical attaché
is nevertheless once again under Saudi diplomatic immunity, this time as special ear, nose, throat consultant to the personal physician of Prince Q, the Saudi Minister of Home Entertainment, here on northeastern USA soil, with his legation to cut another mammoth deal with Interlace Tel Entertainment. The medical attaché turns 37 tomorrow, Thursday, the 2nd of April, in the North American lunar YDAU, year of the Depend adult undergarment. The legation finds the promotional subsidy of the North American calendar hilariously vulgar, to say nothing of the arresting image of the idolatrous West's most famous and self-congratulating idol, the colossal libertine statue, wearing some type of enormous adult design diaper, and hilariously apposite image popular in the news photos of so many international journals. The attaché's medical practice being normally divided between Montreal and the Rub Akali, it is his first trip back to USA soil since completing his residency 8 years ago. His duties here involve migrating with the prince and his retinue between Interlace's two hubs of manufacture and dissemination in Phoenix, Arizona, USA, and Boston, Massachusetts, USA, respectively, offering expert ENT assistance to the personal physician of Prince Q. The medical attaché's particular expertise is the maxillofacial consequences of imbalances in intestinal flora. Prince Q, as would anyone who refuses to eat pretty much anything but Toblerone, suffers chronically from Candida albicans, with attendant susceptibilities to manilial sinusitis and thrush, the yeasty sores and sinal impactions of which require almost daily drainage in the cold and damp of early spring Boston, USA. A veritable artist possessed of a deftness nonpareil with cotton swab and evacuation hypo, the medical attaché is known among the shrinking upper classes of petro-Arab nations as the Debakey of maxillofacial yeast. His staggering fee scale is holy ad valorem. Saudi consulting fees in particular are somewhere just past obscene, but the medical attaché's duties on this trip are personally draining and sort of nauseous, and when he arrives back at the sumptuous apartments he had his wife sublet in districts far from the legation's normal Back Bay and Scottsdale digs, at the day's end, he needs unwinding in the very worst way. A more than averagely devout follower of the North American Sufism, promulgated in his childhood by Pir Valayat, the medical attaché partakes of neither kif nor distilled spirits, and must unwind without chemical aid. When he arrives home after evening prayers, he wants to look upon a spicy and 100% Sharia halal dinner, piping hot and arranged and steaming pleasantly on its attractive tray. He wants his bib ironed and laid out by the tray at the ready. And he wants the living room's teleputer booted and warmed up, and the evening's entertainment cartridges already selected and arranged and lined up in dock, ready for remote insertion into the viewer's drive. He reclines before the viewer in his special electronic recliner, and his black-veiled, ethnically Arab wife wordlessly attends him, loosening any constrictive clothing, adjusting the room's lighting, fitting the complexly molded dinner tray over his head so that his shoulders support the tray and allow it to project into space just below his chin, that he may enjoy his hot dinner without having to remove his eyes from whatever entertainment is up and playing. He has a narrow imperial-style beard, which his wife also attends, and keeps free of detritus from the tray just below. The medical attaché sits and watches and eats and watches, unwinding by visible degrees, until the angles of his body in the chair and his head on his neck indicate that he has passed into sleep, at which point his special electronic recliner can be made automatically to recline to full horizontal, and luxuriant silk analog bedding emerges, flowing from long slots in the appliance's sides. And, unless his wife is inconsiderate and clumsy with the recliner's remote handheld controls, the medical attaché is permitted to ease effortlessly from unwound spectation
into a fully relaxed night's sleep. Still right there in the recumbent recliner. The teepee set to run a recursive loop of low-volume surf and light rain on broad green leaves. Except, that is, for Wednesday nights, which in Boston are permitted to be his wife's Arab Women's Advanced League tennis night with the other legation wives and companions at the plush Mount Auburn Club in West Watertown, on which nights she is not around wordlessly to attend him, since Wednesday is the USA weekday on which fresh Toblerone hits Boston, Massachusetts, USA's Newbury Street's import confectioner's shelves. And the Saudi Minister of Home Entertainment's inability to control his appetites for Wednesday, Toblerone, often requires the medical attaché to remain in personal attendance all evening on the bulk-rented 14th floor of the Back Bay Hilton, juggling tongue depressors and cotton swabs, Nystadin and ibuprofen and styptics and antibiotic thrush salves, rehabilitating the mucous membranes of the dyspeptic and distressed and often, but not always, penitent and appreciative Saudi Prince Q. So, on the 1st of April, YDAU, when the medical attaché is, it is alleged, insufficiently deft with a Q-tip on an ulcerated sinal necrosis, and is subjected, at just 1,800 hours, to a fit of febrile thrush of pique from the florally imbalanced Minister of Home Entertainment, and is by high-volume fiat replaced at the royal bedside by the prince's personal physician, who summoned by beeper from the Hilton sauna, and when the damp personal physician pats the medical attaché on the shoulder and tells him to pay the peak no mind, that it's just the yeast talking, but to just head on home and unwind and for once make a well-deserved early Wednesday evening of it. And but so when the attaché does get home at like 1840 hours, his spacious Boston apartments are empty, the living room lights undimmed, dinner unheated and the attachable tray still in the dishwasher, and worst, of course, no entertainment cartridges have been obtained from the Boylston Street Interlace outlet, where the medical attaché's wife, like all the veiled wives and companions of the prince's legatees, has a complimentary goodwill account. And even if he weren't far too exhausted and tightly wound to venture back into the damp urban night to pick up entertainment cartridges, the medical attaché realizes that his wife has, as always on Wednesdays, taken the car with the diplomatic immunity license plates, without which your thinking alien wouldn't even dream of trying to park publicly at night in Boston, Massachusetts, USA. The medical attaché's unwinding options are thus severely constricted. The living room's lavish teepee receives also the spontaneous disseminations of the Interlace subscription pulse matrix. But the procedures for ordering specific spontaneous pulses from the service are so technologically and cryptographically complex that the attaché has always left the whole business to his wife. On this Wednesday night, trying buttons and abbreviations almost at random, the attaché is able to summon up only live USA professional sports, which he has always found brutish and repellent, Texaco Oil Company sponsored opera, which the attaché has seen today, more than enough of the human uvula, thank you very much, a re-disseminated episode of the popular afternoon Interlace children's program, Mr. Bouncity Bounce, which the attaché thinks for a moment might be a documentary on bipolar mood disorders, until he catches on and thumbs the selection panel hastily, and a re-disseminated session of the scantily clad variable impact early AM Fit Forever home aerobics series of the Interlace aerobics guru, Ms. Tony Kondo. The scantily clad and splay-limbed immodesty of which threatens the devout medical attaché with the possibility of impure thoughts. The only entertainment cartridges anywhere in the apartment, a foul-tempered search reveals, are those which have arrived in Wednesday's USA postal delivery. Left on the sideboard in the living room, along with personal and professional faxes and mail, the medical attaché declines to read until it's been pre-scanned by his wife for relevant interest to himself. The sideboard is against the wall opposite the room's electronic recliner under a triptych of high-quality Byzantine erotica. The padded cartridge mailers, with their distinctive rectangular bulge, are mixed haphazardly in with the less entertaining mail. Searching for something to unwind with, the medical attaché tears the different padded mailers open along their designated perforations. There is an ONANMA specialty service film on actinomycete class antibiotics and irritable bowel syndrome. There is the April 1st YDAU's CBC Pate North American News Summary 40-minute cartridge, available daily by a wife's auto subscription, and either transmitted to TP by unrecordable interlaced pulse or express posted on a single play ROM self-erasing disc. There is the Arabic language video edition of April's Self magazine for the attaché's wife. Nasa's covers, model chastely swathed and veiled. There is a plain brown and irritatingly untitled cartridge case in a featureless white 3-day standard USA first-class padded cartridge mailer. The padded mailer is postmarked Suburban Phoenix area in Arizona, USA, and the return address box has only the term Happy Anniversary with a small, drawn, crude face smiling in ballpoint ink instead of a return address or incorporated logo. Though by birth and residence a native of Quebec, where the language of discourse is not English, the medical attaché knows quite well that the English word anniversary does not mean the same as birthday. And the medical attaché and his veiled wife were united in the eyes of God and prophet not in April, but in October, 4 years prior, in the Rub al-Khali. Adding to the padded mailer's confusion is the fact that anything from Prince Q's legation in Phoenix, Arizona, USA, would carry a diplomatic seal instead of routine ONAN postage. The medical attaché, in sum, feels tightly wound and badly underappreciated and is prepared in advance to be irritated by the item inside, which is merely a standard black entertainment cartridge, but is wholly unlabeled and not in any sort of colorful or informative or inviting cartridge case, and has only another of these vapid USA-type circular smiling heads embossed upon it, where the registration and duration codes are supposed to be embossed. The medical attaché is puzzled by the cryptic mailer and face and case and unlabeled entertainment, and preliminarily irritated by the amount of time he's had to spend upright at the sideboard attending to mail, which is not his task. The sole reason he does not throw the unlabeled cartridge in the waste can or put it aside for his wife to preview for relevance is because there are such woefully slim entertainment pickings on his wife's irritating, Americanized tennis league evening away from her place at home. The attaché will pop the cartridge in and scan just enough of its contents to determine whether it is irritating or of an irrelevant nature and not entertaining or engaging in any way. He will heat the prepared halal lamb and spicy halal garnish in the microwave oven until piping hot. Arrange it attractively on his tray, preview the first few moments of the puzzling and or irritating or possibly mysteriously blank entertainment cartridge first, then unwind with the news summary. Then perhaps have a quick, unlibidinous look at Nasa's spring line of sexless black devout women's wear. Then we'll insert the recursive surf and rain cartridge and make a well-deserved early Wednesday evening of it, hoping only that his wife will not return from her tennis league in her perspiration-dampened black ankle-length tennis ensemble and remove his dinner tray from his sleeping neck in a clumsy or undeft fashion that will awaken him, potentially. When he settles in with the tray and cartridge, the TP's viewer's digital display reads 1927 hours. Year of the trial-size dove bar. Wardine say her mama ain't treat her right. Reginald, he come round to my blacktop at my building where me and Dolores Epps jump double dutch, and he say, Planette, Wardine be down in my crib, cry say her mama ain't treat her right. And I go on with Reginald to his building where he live at, and Wardine be sit deep far back in a closet in Reginald's crib, and she be cry. Reginald gonna lift Wardine out the closet, and me with him crying, and I be rub on the wet all over Wardine's face. And Reginald be so careful when he took off all her shirts she got on. Tell Wardine to let me see.
Claudine back, all beat up and cut up. Big stripes of cut all up and down Claudine back. Pink stripes and around the stripes of skin like the skin on folks' lips be like. Sick down in my insides to look at it. Claudine be crying. Reginald say Claudine say her mama ain't treat her right. Say her mama beat Claudine with a hanger. Say Claudine mama, man. Roy, Tony, we want to lie down with Claudine. We give Claudine candy and fines. We stand in her way in Claudine's face and he ain't let her pass without he all the time touching her. Reginald say Claudine say Roy, Tony at night when Claudine mama at work. He come into the mattresses where Claudine and William and Chantel and Roy the baby sleep at. And he stand there in the dark, high, and say quiet things at her and breathe. Claudine mama say Claudine tempt Roy Tony into sin. Claudine say, she say Claudine try to take away Roy Tony into evil and sin with her young tight self. She beat Claudine back with hangers out the closet. My mama say Claudine mama not right in her head. My mama scared of Roy Tony. Claudine be crying. Reginald he down and beg for Claudine to tell Reginald mama how Claudine mama treat Claudine. Reginald say he love his Claudine. Say he love but ain't never before this time could understand why Claudine won't lie down with him like girls do their man. Say Claudine ain't never let Reginald take off her shirts until tonight. She come to Reginald's crib in his building and be crying. And she let Reginald take off her shirts to see how Claudine mama beat Claudine because Roy Tony. Reginald love his Claudine. Claudine be like to die scared. She say no to Reginald beg. She say if she go to Reginald mama, then Reginald mama go to Claudine mama. Then Claudine mama think Claudine be lie down with Reginald. Claudine say her mama say, Claudine let a man lie down before she's 16 and she beat Claudine to death. Reginald say he ain't no way gonna let that happen to Claudine. Roy Tony killed Dolores Epps' brother, Columbus Epps, at the Brighton Projects 4 years gone. Roy Tony on parole. Claudine say he show Claudine he got something on his ankle, sent radio signals to parole, but he's still here in Brighton. Roy Tony can't be leave Brighton. Roy Tony brother be Claudine's father. He gone. Reginald try to hush Claudine, but he cannot stop Claudine cry. Claudine look like crazy, she's so scared. She say she kill herself if me or Reginald tell our mamas. She say, Clinette, you my half-sister. I am beg you that you do not tell your mama or my mama and Roy Tony. Reginald tell Claudine to hush herself and lie down quiet. He put shed spread out the kitchen on Claudine cuts on her back. He run his finger with grease so careful down pink line to her getting beat with her hanger. Claudine say she do not feel nothing on her back ever since spring. She lies stomach on Reginald's floor and say she ain't got no feeling in her skin of her back. When Reginald gone to get the water, she asked me the truth. How bad is her back look when Reginald look at it? Is she still pretty? She cried. I ain't tell my mama on Claudine and Reginald and Claudine mama and Roy Tony. My mama scared of Roy Tony. My mama be the lady Roy Tony killed Columbus Epps over 4 years gone in the Brighton Projects for love. But I know Reginald tell. Reginald say he gonna die before Claudine mama beat Claudine again. He say he take himself up to Roy Tony and say him not to mess with Claudine or breathe by her mattress at night. He say he take himself on down to the playground at the Brighton Projects where Roy Tony do business. And he go to Roy Tony man to man and he make Roy Tony make it all right. But I think Roy Tony gonna kill Reginald if Reginald go. I think Roy Tony gonna kill Reginald. And then Claudine mama beat Claudine to death with a hanger. And then nobody knows except me. And I'm gonna have a child. In the 8th American educational grade, Bruce Green fell dreadfully in love with a classmate who had the unlikely name of Mildred Bonk. The name was unlikely because if ever an 8th grader looked like a Daphne Christensen or a Kimberly St. Simone, something like that, it was Mildred Bonk. She was the kind of fatally pretty and nubile wraith-like figure who glides through the sweaty junior high corridors of every nocturnal emitter's dreamscape.
Hair that Green had heard described by an overwrought teacher as flaxen. A body which the fickle angel of puberty, the same angel who didn't even seem to know Bruce Green's zip code, had visited, kissed, and already left back in sixth. Legs which not even orange keds with purple glitter-encrusted laces could make unserious. Shy, iridescent, cultish, pelvically infractious, amply busted, given to diffident movements of hand brushing flaxen hair from front of dear creamy forehead, movements which drove Bruce Green up a private tree. A vision in a sundress and silly shoes. Mildred L. Bonk. And then, but by 10th grade, in one of those queer, when did that happen metamorphoses, Mildred Bonk had become an imposing member of the frightening Winchester High School set that smoked full-strength Marlboros in the alley between senior and junior halls and that left school altogether at lunchtime, driving away in loud, low-slung cars to drink beer and smoke dope, driving around with sound systems of illegal wattage, using Visine and Clorette, etc. She was one of them. She chewed gum, or worse, in the cafeteria. Her dear, diffident face now a bored mask of attitude. Her flaxen locks now teased and gelled into what looked, for all the world, like the consequence of a finger stuck into an electric socket. Bruce Green saved up for a low-slung old car and practiced attitude on the aunt who'd taken him in. He developed a will. And by the year of what would have been graduation, Bruce Green was way more bored, imposing, and frightening than even Mildred Bonk. And he and Mildred Bonk and tiny, incontinent Harriet Bonk Green lived just off the Alston Spur in a shiny house trailer with another frightening couple and with Tommy Ducey, the infamous hair-lipped pot and sundries dealer who kept several large snakes in unclean, uncovered aquaria, which smelled, which Tommy Ducey didn't notice because his upper lip completely covered his nostrils, and all he could smell was lip. Mildred Bonk got high in the afternoon and watched cereal cartridges, and Bruce Green had a steady job at Leisure Time Ice. And for a while, life was more or less one big party. Year of the Depend Adult Undergarment. Hal? Hey, Hal. Yes, Mario? Are you asleep? Boo-boo, we've been over this. I can't be asleep if we're talking.
That's what I thought.
Happy to reassure you.
Boy, were you on today. Boy, did you ever make that guy look sick. When he hit that one down the line and you got it and fell down and hit that drop volley.
Pemula said the guy looked like he was going to be sick all over the net, he said. Boo, I kicked that kid's ass is all. End of story. I don't think it's good to rehash it when I've kicked somebody's ass.
It's like a dignity thing.
I think we should just let it sort of lie in state, quietly. Speaking of which... Hey, Hal. It's late, Mario. It's sleepy time. Close your eyes and think fuzzy thoughts.
That's what the moms always says, too.
Always work for me, boo.
You think? I think fuzzy thoughts all the time. You let me room with you because you feel sorry for me.
Boo-boo, I'm not even going to dignify that. I'll regard it as, like, a warning sign. You always get petulant when you don't get enough sleep. And here we are seeing petulance already on the western horizon, right here.
When I asked if you were asleep, I was going to ask if you felt like you believed in God today out there, when you were so on, making that guy look sick.
This again? Really don't think midnight in a totally dark room, with me so tired my hair hurts, and drills in 6 short hours is the time and place to get into this, Mario.
You ask me this once a week.
You never say is why.
So tonight, to shush you, how about if I say I have administrative bones to pick with God, boo?
I'll say God seems to have a kind of laid-back management style I'm not crazy about. I'm pretty much anti-death. God looks, by all accounts, to be pro-death.
I'm not seeing how we can get together on this issue, he and I, Boo.
You're talking about since himself passed away. See? You never say. I do too say. I just did. I just didn't happen to say what you wanted to hear, Boo-Boo, is all. There's a difference.
I don't get how you couldn't feel like you believed today out there. It was so right there. You moved like you totally believed. How do you feel inside not?
Mario, you and I are mysterious to each other.
We countenance each other from either side of some unbridgeable difference on this issue. Let's lie very quietly and ponder this.
Al? Hey, Hal. I'm going to propose that I tell you a joke, Boo, on the condition that afterward you shush and let me sleep.
Is it a good one?
Mario, what do you get when you cross an insomniac, an unwilling agnostic, and a dyslexic?
I give.
You get somebody who stays up all night torturing himself mentally over the question of whether or not there's a dog.
That's a good one.
Shush.
Hey, Hal, what's an insomniac?
Somebody who rooms with you, kid, that's for sure.
Hey, Hal, how come the moms never cried when himself passed away?
I cried. And you, even CT cried. I saw him personally cry.
You listened to Tosco over and over and cried and said you were sad. We all were. Hey, Hal, did the mom seem like she got happier after himself passed away to you? It seems like she got happier. She seems even taller. She stopped traveling everywhere all the time for this and that thing. The corporate grammar thing. The library protest thing. Now she never goes anywhere, Boo. Now she's got the headmaster's house and her office and the tunnel in between and never leaves the grounds.
She's a worse workaholic than she ever was. And more obsessive compulsive. When's the last time you saw a dust mote in that house?
Hey, Hal.
Now she's just an agoraphobic workaholic and obsessive compulsive. This strikes you as happification?
Her eyes are better. They don't seem as sunk in. They look better. She laughs at CT way more than she laughed at himself. She laughs from lower down inside. She laughs more. Her jokes she tells are better ones than yours even now, a lot of the time. How come she never got sad?
She did get sad, Boo-Boo. She just got sad in her way instead of yours and mine. She got sad, I'm pretty sure.
Hal, you remember how the staff lowered the flag to half-mast out in front of the portcullis here after it happened? Do you remember that? And it goes to half-mast every year at convocation? Remember the flag, Boo?
Hey, Hal.
Don't cry, Boo-Boo. Remember the flag only halfway up the pole? Boo-Boo, there are two ways to lower a flag to half-mast. Are you listening? Because no shit, I really have to sleep here in a second, so listen. One way to lower the flag to half-mast is just to lower the flag. There's another way, though. You can also just raise the pole. You can raise the pole to, like, twice its original height. You get me? You understand what I mean, Mario?
Hell.
She's plenty sad, I bet.
At 2010 hours, on the 1st of April, YDAU, the medical attaché is still watching the unlabeled entertainment cartridge. October, year of the Depend adult undergarment. For Orin and Candenza, number 71, morning is the soul's night, the day's worst time, psychically.
He cranks the condo's AC way down at night and still most mornings wakes up soaked, fetally curled, entombed in that kind of psychic darkness where you're dreading whatever you think of. Hal Incandenza's brother Orin wakes up alone at 0730 hours amid a damp scent of ambush, and on the other side's dented pillow a note with a phone number and vital data in a loopy schoolgirlish hand. There's also ambush on the note. His side of the bed is soaked. Orin makes honey toast, standing barefoot at the kitchen counter wearing briefs and an old academy sweatshirt with the arms cut off, squeezing honey from the head of a plastic bear. The floor so cold it hurts his feet, but the double-pane window over the sink is hot to the touch. The beastly Metro Phoenix October AM heat just outside. Home with the team, no matter how high the AC or how thin the sheet, Orin wakes with his own impression sweated darkly into the bed beneath him, slowly drying all day to a white, salty outline, just slightly off from the week's other faint, dried outlines. So his fetal-shaped, fossilized image is fanned out across his side of the bed like a deck of cards, just overlapping, like an acid trail or timed exposure. The heat just past the glass doors tightens his scalp. He takes breakfast out to a white iron table by the condo complex's central pool and tries to eat it there, in the heat, the coffee not steaming or cooling. He sits there in dumb animal pain. He has a mustache of sweat. A bright beach ball floats and bumps against one side of the pool. The sun, like a sneaky keyhole view of hell. No one else out here. The complex is a ring with a pool and deck and jacuzzi in the center. Heat shimmers off the deck like fumes from fuel. There's that mirage thing where the extreme heat makes the dry deck look wet with fuel. Orin can hear cartridge viewers going from behind closed windows, that aerobics show every morning, and also someone playing an organ, and the older woman who won't ever smile back at him in the apartment next to his doing operatic scales, muffled by drapes and sun curtains and double panes. The jacuzzi chugs and foams. The note from last night's subject is on violet bond, once folded, and with a circle of darker violet dead center where the subject's perfume spritzer had hit it. The only interesting thing about the script, but also depressing, is that every single circle, O's, D's, P's, and numbers 6 and 8, is darkened in, while the I's are dotted not with circles, but with tiny little Valentine hearts, which are not darkened in. Orin reads the note while he eats toast. That's mainly an excuse for the honey. He uses his smaller right arm to eat and drink. His oversized left arm and big left leg remain at rest at all times in the morning. A breeze sends the beach ball skating all the way across the blue pool to the other side, and Orin watches its noiseless glide. The white iron tables have no umbrellas, and you can tell where the sun is without looking. You can feel right where it is on your body and project from there. The ball moves tentatively back out toward the middle of the pool and then stays there, not even bothering. The same small breezes make the rotted palms along the condominium complex's stone walls rustle and click, and a couple of fronds detach and spiral down, hitting the deck with a slap. All the plants out here are malevolent, heavy, and sharp. The parts of the palms above the fronds are tufted in sick stuff like coconut hair. Roaches and other things live in the trees. Rats, maybe. Loathsome high-altitude critters of all kinds. All the plants either spiny or meaty. Cacti in queer, tortured shapes. The tops of the palms like Rod Stewart's hair from days gone by. Orin returned with the team from the Chicago game two nights ago, Red Eye. He knows that he and the place kicker are the only two starters who are not still in terrible pain, physically, from the beating. The day before they left, so like 5 days ago, Orin was out by himself in the jacuzzi by the pool late in the day, caring for the leg, sitting in the radiant heat and bloody late-day light with the leg in the jacuzzi. Absently squeezing the tennis ball he still absently squeezes out of habit. Watching the jacuzzi funnel
and bubble and foam around the leg. And out of nowhere, a bird had all of a sudden fallen into the jacuzzi. With a flat, matter-of-fact plop, out of nowhere. Out of the wide, empty sky. Nothing overhung the jacuzzi but sky. The bird seemed to have just had a coronary or something in flight and died and fallen out of the empty sky and landed dead in the jacuzzi, right by the leg. He brought his sunglasses down onto the bridge of his nose with a finger and looked at it. It was an undistinguished kind of bird, not a predator. Like a wren, maybe. It seems like no way could it have been a good sign. The dead bird bobbed and barrel rolled in the foam, sucked under 1 second and reappearing the next, creating an illusion of continued flight. Oren had inherited none of the mom's phobias about disorder, hygiene. Not crazy about bugs, though. Roaches. But he just sat there squeezing the ball, looking at the bird without a conscious thought in his head. By the next morning, waking up, curled and entombed, it seemed like it had to have been a bad sign, though. Oren now always gets the shower so hot it's to where he can just barely stand it. The condo's whole bathroom is done in this kind of minty yellow tile he didn't choose. Maybe chosen by the free safety who lived here before the Cardinals sent New Orleans the free safety, 2 reserve guards and cash for Oren Incandenza, punter. And no matter how many times he has the Terminex people out, there are still the enormous roaches that come out of the bathroom drains. Sewer roaches, according to Terminex. Blataria implacablus, or something. Really huge roaches. Armored vehicle-type bugs. Totally black with Kevlar-type cases. The works. And fearless. Raised in the Hobbesian sewers down there. Boston's and New Orleans' little brown roaches were bad enough. But you could at least come in and turn on the light and they'd run for their lives. These Southwest sewer roaches. You turn on the light, and they just look up at you from the tile like, you got a problem? Oren stomped on one of them, only once, that had come up hellishly out of the drain in the shower when he was in there, showering. Going out naked and putting shoes on and coming in and trying to conventionally squash it, and the result was explosive. There's still material from that one time in the tile grouting. It seems unremovable. Roach innards. Sickening. Throwing the shoes away is preferable to looking at the sole to clean it. Now, he keeps big glass tumblers in the bathroom, and when he turns on the light and sees a roach, he puts a glass down over it, trapping it. After a couple of days, the glass is all steamed up and the roach has asphyxiated, messlessly. And Oren discards both the roach and the tumbler in separate sealed ziplocks in the dumpster complex by the golf course up the street. The yellow tile floor of the bathroom is sometimes a little obstacle course of glasses with huge roaches dying inside, stoically, just sitting there, the glasses gradually steaming up with roach dioxide. The whole thing makes Oren sick. Now he figures the hotter the shower's water, the less chance any small armored vehicle is going to feel like coming out of the drain while he's in there. Sometimes they're in the bowl of the toilet first thing in the AM, dog paddling, trying to get to the side and climb up. He's also not crazy about spiders, though more like unconsciously. He's never come any place close to the conscious horror himself had somehow developed about the Southwest's black widows and their chaotic webs. The widows are all over the place, both here and Tucson, spottable on all but the coldest nights. Their dusty webs without any kind of pattern, plotting just about any right-angled place that's dim or out of the way. Terminex's toxins are more effective on the widows. Oren has them out monthly. He's on like a subscription plan over at Terminex. Oren's special conscious horror, besides heights and the early morning, is roaches. There had been parts of Metro Boston near the bay he'd refused to go to as a child. Roaches give him the howling phantods. The parishes around N.O. had been having a spate or outbreak of a certain Latin origin breed of sinister tropical flying roaches that were small and timid but could fucking fly.
and that kept being found swarming on New Orleans infants at night, in their cribs, especially infants in, like, tenements or squalor, and that reportedly fed on the mucus in the baby's eyes, some special sort of optical mucus, the stuff of fucking nightmares. Mobile flying roaches that wanted to get at your eyes as an infant and were reportedly blinding them. Parents had come in the ghastly AM tenement light and find their infants blind. Like a dozen blinded infants that last summer. And it was during this spate or nightmarish outbreak, plus July flooding that sent over a dozen nightmarish dead bodies from a hilltop graveyard, sliding all gray-blue down the incline. Orin and two teammates had their townhouse on in suburban Chalmette, shedding limbs and innards all the way down the hillside's mud, and one morning coming to rest against the post of their roadside mailbox when Orin came out for the morning paper, that Orin had had his agent put out the trade feelers. And so, to the glass canyons and merciless light of Metro Phoenix, in a kind of desiccated circle, near the Tucson of his own father's desiccated youth. It's the mornings after the spider and heights dreams that are the most painful. That it takes sometimes 3 coffees and 2 showers and sometimes a run to loosen the grip on his soul's throat. And these post-dream mornings are even worse if he wakes up unalone, if the previous night's subject is still there, wanting to twitter or to cuddle and like spoon, asking what exactly is the story with the foggy inverted tumblers on the bathroom floor, commenting on his night sweats, clattering around in the kitchen, making kippers or bacon or something even more hideous and unhoneyed he's supposed to eat with post-coital male gusto. The ones who have this thing about, they call it, feeding my man, wanting a man who can barely keep down AM honey toast to eat with male gusto, elbows out and shoveling, making little noises. Even when alone, able to uncurl alone and sit up slowly and wring out the sheet and go to the bathroom, these darkest mornings start days that Orin can't even bring himself for hours to think about how he'll get through the day. These worst mornings with cold floors and hot windows and merciless light, the soul's certainty that the day will have to be not traversed but sort of climbed vertically, and then that going to sleep again at the end of it will be like falling again off something tall and sheer. So now his own eye mucus is secure in the desert southwest, but the bad dreams have gotten worse since the trade to this blasted area himself had fled long ago as an unhappy youngster. As a nod to Orin's own unhappy youth, all the dreams seem to open briefly with some sort of competitive tennis situation. Last night's it started with a wide-angle shot of Orin on a hard-true court, waiting to receive serve from someone vague, some academy person. Ross Reek, maybe. Good old M. Bain. Or gray-toothed Walt Fletchett, now a teaching pro in the Carolinas. When the dream's screen tightens on him and abruptly dissolves to the blank dark rose color of eyes closed against bright light, and there's the ghastly feeling of being submerged and not knowing which way to head for the surface and air. And after some interval, the dreams Orin struggles up from this kind of visual suffocation to find his mother's head, Mrs. Avril M. T. Incandences, the mom's disconnected head, attached face to face to his own fine head, strapped tight to his face somehow by a wraparound system of VS high pro top shelf lamb gut string from his academy racket's own face, so that no matter how frantically Orin tries to move his head or shake it side to side or twist up his face or roll his eyes, he's still staring at, into, and somehow through his mother's face, as if the mom's head was some sort of overtight helmet Orin can't wrestle his way out of. In the dream, it's understandably vital to Orin that he disengage his head from this phylactery-ish bind of his mother's disembodied head, and he cannot. Last night's subject's note indicates that at some point last night, Orin had clutched her head with both hands and tried to sort of stiff-arm her, though not in an ungentle or complaining way. The note, not the stiff-arm.
The apparent amputation of Mom's head from the rest of the Mom's appears in the dream to be clean and surgically neat. There is no evidence of a stump or any kind of nubbin of neck, even. And it is as if the base of the round, pretty head had been sealed and also sort of rounded off so that her head is a large living ball, a globe with a face attached to his own head's face. The subject after Bane's sister, but before the one just before this one, with the ambush scent and the hearts over eyes, the previous subject had been a sallowly pretty Arizona State developmental psychology grad student with two kids and outrageous alimony and penchants for sharp jewelry, refrigerated chocolate, interlaced educational cartridges, and professional athletes who thrashed in their sleep. Not real bright. She thought the figure he'd trace without thinking on her bare flank after sex was the numeral 8, to give you an idea. Their last morning together, right before he'd mailed her child an expensive toy and then had his phone number changed, he'd awakened from a night of horror show dreams, woke up with an abrupt fetal spasm, unrefreshed and benighted of soul, his eyes wobbling and his wet silhouette on the bottom sheet like a coroner's chalk outline. He woke to find the subject up and sitting up against the reading pillow, wearing his sleeveless Academy sweatshirt and sipping hazelnut espresso and watching, on the cartridge viewing system that occupied half the bedroom's south wall, something horrific called Interlace Educational Cartridges in conjunction with CBC Educational Programming Matrix presents Schizophrenia, Mind or Body. And it had to lie there, moist and paralyzed, curled fetal on his own sweat shadow, and watch on the viewer, a pale young guy about Hal's age, with copper stubble and a red cowlick and flat, blank, affectless black doll's eyes, stare into space stage left, while a brisk Albertan voiceover explained that Fenton here was a dyed-in-the-wool paranoid schizophrenic who believed that radioactive fluids were invading his skull and that hugely complex high-tech type machines had been specially designed and programmed to pursue him without cease until they caught him and made brutal sport of him and buried him alive. It was an old, late millennial CBC public interest Canadian news documentary, digitally sharpened and re-disseminated under the Interlace imprimatur. Interlace could get kind of seedy and low rent during early morning off hours in terms of spontaneous disseminations. And so, but since the old CBC documentary's thesis was turning out pretty clearly to be schizophrenia body, the voiceover evinced great clipped good cheer as it explained that, well, yes, our old Fenton here is more or less hopeless as an extra institutional functioning unit, but that on the upside, science could at least give his existence some sort of meaning by studying him very carefully to help learn how schizophrenia manifested itself in the human body's brain. That, in other words, with the aid of cutting-edge positron emission tomography, or PET technology, since supplanted wholly by invasive digitals, Orin hears the developmental psychology graduate student mutter to herself, watching rapt over her cup, unaware that Orin's paralytically awake. They could scan and study how different parts of poor old Fenton's dysfunctional brain emitted positrons in a whole different topography than your average hale and hearty, non-delusional, God-fearing Albertan's brain. Advancing science by injecting test subject Fenton here with a special blood-brain barrier penetrating radioactive dye and then sticking him in the rotating body-sized receptacle of a PET scanner. On the viewer, it's an enormous gray metal machine that looks like something co-designed by James Cameron and Fritz Lang. And now have a look at this Fenton fellow's eyes as he starts to get the gist of what the voiceover is saying. And in a terse old public TV cut, they now showed subject Fenton in five-point canvas restraints, whipping his copper-haired head from side to side as guys in mint-green surgical masks and caps inject him with radioactive fluids through a turkey baster-sized syringe. Then, good old Fenton's eyes bugging out in total foreseen horror as he's rolled toward the huge gray PET device and slid like an unrisen loaf into the thing's open maw until only his decay-colored sneakers are in view. And the body-sized receptacle rotates the test subject counterclockwise with brutal speed
so that the old sneakers point up, and then left, and then down, and then right, and then up, faster and faster. The machine's blurps and tweets not even coming close to covering Fenton's entombed howls as his worst delusional fears came true in digital stereo, and you could hear the last surviving bits of his functional, dye-permeated mind being screamed out of him for all time as the viewer digitally superimposed an image of Fenton's ember-red and neutron-blue brain in the lower right corner, where Interlace's time-temp functions usually appear, and the brisk voiceover gave capsule histories of first paranoid schizophrenia, and then PET. With Orin lying there, slit-eyed, wet and neuralgic, with AM dread, wishing the subject would put her own clothes and sharp jewelry on and take the rest of her Toblerone out of the freezer and go, so he could go to the bathroom and get yesterday's asphyxiated roaches into an EWD dumpster before the dumpster's all filled for the day, and decide what kind of expensive present to mail the subject's kid. And then, the matter of the dead bird, out of nowhere. And then, news of pressure from the AZ Cardinal Administration to cooperate with some sort of insipid-type personality profile series of interviews with some profiler from Moment Magazine, with personal background-ish questions to be answered in some blandly sincere team PR way, the unexamined stress of which drives him to start calling Haley again. Reopen that whole Pandora's box of worms. Orin also shaves in the shower. Face red with heat, wreathed in steam, by feel, shaving upward with south to north strokes as he was taught. Year of the Depend Adult Undergarment. Here's Hal in Condensa. Age 17, with his little brass one-hitter, getting covertly high in the Enfield Tennis Academy's underground pump room and exhaling palely into an industrial exhaust room. It's the sad little interval after afternoon matches and conditioning, but before the Academy's communal supper. Hal is by himself down here, and nobody knows where he is or what he's doing. Hal likes to get high in secret. But a bigger secret is that he's as attached to the secrecy as he is to getting high. A one-hitter, sort of like a long FDR-type cigarette holder whose end is packed with a pinch of good dope, gets hot and is hard on the mouth, the brass ones especially. But one-hitters have the advantage of efficiency. Every particle of ignited pot gets inhaled. There's none of the incidental second-hand-type smoke from a party bowl's big load, and Hal can take every iota way down deep and hold his breath forever, so that even his exhalations are no more than slightly pale and sick, sweet-smelling. Total utilization of available resources equals lack of publicly detectable waste. The Academy's tennis court's lungs pump room is underground and accessible only by tunnel. ETA is abundantly, embranchingly, tunneled. This is by design. Plus, one-hitters are small, which is good because, let's face it, anything you use to smoke high-resin dope with is going to stink. A bong is big, and its stink is going to be, like, commensurately big. Plus, you have the foul bong water to deal with. Pipes are smaller and at least portable, but they always come with only a multi-hit party bowl that disperses non-utilized smoke over a wide area. A one-hitter can be wastelessly employed, then allowed to cool, wrapped in two baggies, and then further wrapped and sealed in a Ziploc, and then enclosed in two sport socks, in a gear bag along with the lighter, and eye drops, and mint pellets, and the little film case of dope itself. And it's highly portable and odor-free and basically totally covert. As far as Hal knows, colleagues Michael Pemulis, Jim Struck, Bridget C. Boone, Jim Trolch, Ted Schacht, Trevor Axford, and possibly Kyle D. Coyle and Tall Paul Shaw, and remotely, possibly, Franny Unwin, all know Hal gets regularly, covertly high. It's also not impossible that Bernadette Longley knows, actually. And of course, the unpleasant Kay Freer always has suspicions of all kinds. And Hal's brother Mario knows a thing or two, but that's it, in terms of public knowledge. But even though Pemulus and Struck and Boone and Trolch and Axford, and occasionally, in a sort of medicinal and touristic way, Stice and Shock, all are known to get high also, Hal has actually gotten actively high only with Pemulus, on the rare occasions he's gotten high with anybody else, as in person, which he avoids. He'd forgot. Ortho the Darkness Stice of Partridge, Kansas, knows. And Hal's oldest brother, Orin, mysteriously, even long distance, seems to know more than he's coming right out and saying, unless Hal's reading more into some of the phone comments than are there. Hal's mother, Mrs. Avril Incandenza, and her adoptive brother, Dr. Charles Tavis, the current ETA headmaster, both know Hal drinks alcohol sometimes, like on weekend nights with Trolch or maybe Axford, down the hill at clubs on Commonwealth Avenue. The Unexamined Life has its notorious blind bouncer night every Friday, where they card you on the honor system. Mrs. Avril Incandenza isn't crazy about the idea of Hal drinking, mostly because of the way his father had drunk when alive, and reportedly his father's own father before him in Arizona and California. But Hal's academic precocity, and especially his late competitive success on the junior circuit, make it clear that he's able to handle whatever modest amounts she's pretty sure he consumes. There's no way someone can seriously abuse a substance and perform at top, scholarly, and athletic levels, the ETA psych counselor Dr. Rusk assures her, especially the high-level athletic part. And Avril feels it's important that a concerned but unsmothering single parent know when to let go somewhat and let the two high-functioning of her three sons make their own possible mistakes and learn from their own valid experience, no matter how much the secret worry about mistakes tears her gizzard out. The mothers. And Charles supports whatever personal decisions she makes in conscience about her children. And God knows she'd rather have Hal having a few glasses of beer every so often than absorbing God alone knows what sort of esoteric designer compounds with reptilian Michael Pemulus and trail of slime-leaving James Struck, both of whom give Avril a howling case of the maternal phantogs. And ultimately, she's told doctors Rusk and Tavis, she'd rather have Hal abide in the security of the knowledge that his mother trusts him, that she's trusting and supportive and doesn't judge or gizzard tear or wring her fine hands over his having, for instance, a glass of Canadian ale with friends every now and again, and so works tremendously hard to hide her maternal dread of his possibly ever drinking like James himself, or James's father. All so that Hal might enjoy the security of feeling that he can be upfront with her about issues like drinking, and not feel he has to hide anything from her under any circumstances. Dr. Tavis and Dolores Rusk have privately discussed the fact that, not least among the phobic stressors Avril suffers so uncomplainingly with, is a black phobic dread of hiding or secrecy in all possible forms with respect to her sons. Avril and CT know nothing about Hal's penchants for high-resin Bob Hope and underground absorption, which fact Hal obviously likes a lot on some level, though he's never given much thought to why. To why he likes it so much. ETA's hilltop grounds are traversable by tunnel. Avril I, for example, who never leaves the grounds anymore, rarely travels above ground, willing to hunch to take the off-tunnels between Headmaster's house and her office next to Charles Tavis's in the community and administration building. A pink-bricked, white-pillared Neo-Georgian thing that Hal's brother Mario says looks like a cube that has swallowed a ball too big for its stomach.
Three.
Two sets of elevators and one of stairs run between the lobby, reception area, and administrative offices on ComEd's first floor and the weight room, sauna, and locker shower areas on the sub-level below it. One large tunnel of elephant-colored cement leads from just off the boys' showers to the mammoth laundry room below the west courts, and two smaller tunnels
radiate from the sauna area south and east to the sub-basements of the smaller, spherocubular, proto-Georgian buildings, housing classrooms and sub-dormitories B and D. These two basements and smaller tunnels often serve as student storage space and hallways between various pro-rectors' private rooms.
Four.
Then two even smaller tunnels, navigable by any adult willing to assume a kind of knuckle-dragging simian posture, in turn connect each of the sub-basements to the former optical and film development facilities of Leith and Ogilvy, and the late Dr. James O. Incandenza, now deceased, below and just west of the headmaster's house. From which facilities, there's also a fair diametered tunnel that goes straight to the lowest level of the community and administration building. But its functions have gradually changed over 4 years, and it's now too full of exposed wiring and hot water pipes and heating ducts to be really passable. And to the offices of the physical plant, almost directly beneath the center row of ETA outdoor tennis courts, which offices and custodial lounge are in turn connected to ETA's lung storage and pump rooms via a pargeted tunnel hastily constructed by the Testar All-Weather Inflatable Structures Corp., which together with the folks over at the ATHSCME, Industrial Air Displacement Devices, erects and services the inflatable dendrourethane dome, known as the lung, that covers the middle row of courts for the winter indoor season. The crude little rough-sided tunnel between plant and pump is traversable only via all-fours-type crawling and is essentially unknown to staff and administration, popular only with the Academy's smaller kids' tunnel club, as well as with certain adolescents with strong secret incentive to crawl on all fours. The lung storage room is basically impassable from March through November because it's full of intricately folded dendrourethane lung material and dismantled sections of flexible ducting and fan blades, etc. The pump room is right next to it, though you have to crawl back out into the tunnel to get to it. On the engineering diagrams, the pump rooms may be about 20 meters directly beneath the centermost courts in the middle row of courts, and looks like a kind of spider hanging upside down. An unfenestrated oval chamber with six man-sized, curved ducts radiating up and out to exit points on the grounds above. And the pump room has six radial openings, one for each up-curving duct. Three 2-meter vents with huge turbine-bladed exhaust fans bolted into their grills, and three more 2Ms with reversed ATHSCME intake fans that allow air from the ground above to be sucked down and around the room and up into the three exhaust vents. The pump room is essentially like a pulmonary organ, or the epicenter of a massive six-vectored wind tunnel, and when activated roars like a banshee that slammed its hand in the door, though the PR's in full legit operation only when the lung is up, usually November to March. The intake fans pull ground-level winter air down into and around the room and through the three exhaust fans and up the outtake ducts into networks of pneumatic tubing in the lung's sides and dome. It's the pressure of the moving air that keeps the fragile lung inflated. When the quart's lung is down and stored, Hal will descend and walk and then hunch his way in to make sure nobody's in the physical plant quarters. Then he'll hunch and crawl to the PR, gear bag in his teeth, and activate just one of the big exhaust fans and get secretly high and exhale palely through its blades into the vent so that any possible odor is blown through an outtake duct and expelled through a grilled hole on the west side of the west courts, a threaded hole with a flange where brisk, white-suited ATHSCME guys will attach some of the lung's arterial pneumatic tubing at some point soon when Stitt et al. On staff decide the real weather has moved past enduring for outdoor tennis. During winter months, when any expelled odor would get ducted up into the lung and hang there conspicuous, Hal mostly goes into a remote sub-dormitory lavatory and climbs onto a toilet in a stall and exhales into the grill of one of the little exhaust fans in the ceiling.
But this routine lacks a certain intricate subterranean covert drama. It's another reason why Hal dreads Interdependence Day and the approach of the Whataburger Classic and Thanksgiving and unendurable weather and the erection of the lung. Recreational drugs are more or less traditional at any U.S. secondary school, maybe because of the unprecedented tensions, post-latency and puberty and angst and impending adulthood, etc., to help manage the intrapsychic storms, etc. Since the place's inception, there's always been a certain percentage of the high-caliber adolescent players at ETA who manage their internal weathers chemically. Much of this is good, clean, temporary fun, but a traditionally smaller and harder core set tends to rely on personal chemistry to manage ETA's special demands. Dexedrine or low-volt methadrine.
Five.
Before matches, and benzodiazepines to come back down after matches.
Six.
With mudslides or blue flames at some understanding Commonwealth Avenue night spot.
Seven.
Or beers and bongs in some discreet academy corner at night to short-circuit the up-and-down cycle. Mushrooms or X or something from the mild designer class.
Eight.
Or maybe, occasionally, a little black star.
Nine.
Whenever there's a match and demand-free weekend, to basically short out the whole motherboard and blow out all the circuits and slowly recover and be almost neurologically reborn and start the gradual cycle all over again. This circular routine, if your basic wiring's okay to begin with, can work surprisingly well throughout adolescence and sometimes into one's, like, early 20s before it starts to creep up on you. But so, some ETAs, not just Hal and Condensa by any means, are involved with recreational substances, is the point. Like, who isn't at some life stage in the USA and interdependent regions in these troubled times for the most part? Though a decent percentage of ETA students aren't at all, i.e., involved. Some persons can give themselves away to an ambitious pursuit and have that be all the giving themselves away to something they need to do. Though sometimes this changes as the players get older and the pursuit more stress-fraught. American experience seems to suggest that people are virtually unlimited in their need to give themselves away on various levels. Some just prefer to do it in secret. And enrolled student-athlete's use of alcohol or illicit chemicals is cause for immediate expulsion, according to ETA's admissions catalog. But the ETA staff tends to have a lot more important stuff on its plate than policing kids who've already given themselves away to an ambitious competitive pursuit. The administrative attitude under first James Incandenza and then Charles Tavis is like, why would anybody who wanted to compromise his faculties chemically even come here to ETA, where the whole point is to stress and stretch your faculties along multiple vectors?
10.
And since it's the alumni pro-rectors who have the most direct supervisory contact with the kids, and since most of the pro-rectors themselves are depressed or traumatized about not making it into the show and having to come back to ETA and live in decent but subterranean rooms off the tunnels and work as assistant coaches and teach laughable elective classes, which is what the eight ETA pro-rectors do when they're not off playing satellite tournaments or trying to make it through the qualifying rounds of some serious money event. And so they're morose and low on morale and feel bad about themselves often, as a rule. And so, also, not all that surprisingly, tend to get high now and then themselves, though in a less covert or exuberant fashion than the hardcore students' chemical cadre. But so, given all this, it's not hard to see why internal drug enforcement at ETA tends to be flaccid. The other nice thing about the pump room is the way it's connected by tunnel to the pro-rector's rows of housing units, which means men's rooms, which means Hal can crawl, hunch, and tiptoe into an unoccupied men's room and brush his teeth with his portable Oral-B and wash his face and apply eye drops and Old Spice and a plug of wintergreen Kodiak and then saunter back to the sauna area and ascend to ground level, looking and smelling
right as rain. Because when he gets high, he develops a powerful obsession with having nobody, not even the neurochemical cadre, know he's high. This obsession is almost irresistible in its force. The amount of organization and toiletry lugging he has to do to get secretly high in front of a subterranean outtake vent in the pre-supper gap would make a lesser man quail. Hal has no idea why this is, or whence this obsession with the secrecy of it. He broods on it abstractly at times, when high. This no-one-must-know thing. It's not fear per se, fear of discovery. Beyond that, it all gets too abstract and twined up to lead to anything, Hal's brooding. Like most North Americans of his generation, Hal tends to know way less about why he feels certain ways about the objects and pursuits he's devoted to than he does about the objects and pursuits themselves. It's hard to say for sure whether this is even exceptionally bad, this tendency. At 0015 hours, the 2nd of April, the medical attaché's wife is just leaving the Mount Auburn Total Fitness Center, having played 5 6-game pro sets in her little Mideast diplomatic wife tennis circle's weekly round robin. Then hung around the special silver key members lounge with the other ladies, unwrapping her face and hair and playing Nargis and all smoking kif and making extremely delicate and oblique fun of their husband's sexual idiosyncrasies, laughing softly with their hands over their mouths.
11.
The medical attaché at their apartment is still viewing the unlabeled cartridge, which he has rewound to the beginning several times, and then configured for a recursive loop. He sits there, attached to a congealed supper, watching at 0020 hours, having now wet both his pants and the special recliner. 18 in May, Mario Incandenza's designated function around Enfield Tennis Academy is filmic. Sometimes during AM drills or PM matches, he'll be assigned by Coach Schtitt et al. To set up an old camcorder, or whatever video stuffs to hand, on a tripod and record a certain area of court, videotaping different kids' strokes, footwork, certain ticks and hitches and serves or running volleys, so the staff can show the tapes to the kids instructionally, letting the kids see on the screen exactly what a coach or pro rector's talking about. The reason being, it's a lot easier to fix something if you can see it. Autumn, year of dairy products from the American heartland. Drug addicts, driven to crime, to finance their drug addiction, are not often inclined toward violent crime. Violence requires all different kinds of energy, and most drug addicts like to expend their energy not on their professional crime, but on what their professional crime lets them afford. Drug addicts are often burglars, therefore. One reason why the home of someone whose home has been burglarized feels violated and unclean is that there have probably been drug addicts in there. Don Gately was a 27-year-old oral narcotics addict, favoring Demerol and Toluol.
12.
And a more or less professional burglar. And he was, himself, unclean and violated. But he was a gifted burglar when he burgled, though the size of a young dinosaur, with a massive and almost perfectly square head he used to amuse his friends when drunk by letting them open and close elevator doors on, he was, at his professional zenith, smart, sneaky, quiet, quick, possessed of good taste and reliable transportation, with a kind of ferocious jolliness in his attitude toward his livelihood. As an active drug addict, Gately was distinguished by his ferocious and jolly elan. He kept his big square chin up and his smile wide, but he bowed neither toward nor away from any man. He took zero in the way of shit, and was a cheery but implacable exponent of the don't get mad, get even school. Like, for instance, once, after he'd done a really unpleasant 3-month bit in Revere holding on nothing more than a remorseless North Shore assistant district attorney's circumstantial suspicion, finally getting out after 92 days when his PD got the charges dismissed on a right to speedy brief, Gately and a trusted associate paid a semi-professional visit to the private home of this assistant DA, whose zeal and warrant had cost Gately a nasty impromptu detox on the floor of his little holding cell.
13.
Also a believer in the revenge is tastier chilled dictum, Gately had waited patiently until the Eye on People section of the Globe mentioned the ADA and his wife's presence at some celebrity charity sailing thing out in Marblehead. Gately and the associate went that night to the ADA's private home in the upscale Wonderland Valley section of Revere, killed the power to the home with a straight shunt in the meter's inflow, then clipped just the ground wire on the home's pricey HBT alarm, so that the alarm would sound after 10 or so minutes and create the impression that the perps had somehow bungled the alarm and been scared off in the middle of the act. Later that night, when Revere's and Marblehead's finest summoned them home, the ADA and his wife found themselves minus a coin collection and 2 antique shotguns and nothing more. Quite a few other valuables were stacked on the floor of the living room off the foyer, like the perps hadn't had time to get them out of the house. Everything else in the burglarized home looked undisturbed. The ADA was a jaded pro. He walked around touching the brim of his hat and reconstructed probable events.
14.
The perps looked like they'd bungled, disabling the alarm all the way, and had got scared off by the thing's siren when the alarm's pricey HBT alternate ground kicked in at 300 volts. The ADA soothed his wife's sense of violation and uncleanliness. He calmly insisted on sleeping there in their home that very night. No hotel. It was, like, crucial to get right back on the emotional horse in cases like this, he insisted. And then the next day, the ADA worked out the insurance and reported the shotguns to a buddy at ATF. And his wife calmed down, and life went on.
15.
About a month later, an envelope arrived in the ADA's home's exquisite wrought iron mailbox. In the envelope were a standard American Dental Association glossy brochure on the importance of daily oral hygiene, available at like any dentist's office anywhere, and 2 high-pixel Polaroid snapshots, one of Big Don Gately and one of his associate, each in a Halloween mask, denoting a clown's great good professional cheer, each with his pants down and bent over, and each with the enhanced focus handle of one of the couple's toothbrushes protruding from his bottom. Don Gately had sense enough never to work the North Shore again after that, but he ended up in hideous trouble anyway, ADA-wise. It was either bad luck or kismet or so forth. It was because of a cold, a plain old human rhinovirus. And not even Don Gately's cold is what made him finally stop and question his kismet. The thing started out looking like tit on a tray, burglary-wise. A beautiful neo-Georgian home in a wildly upscale part of Brookline was set nicely back from an unlit pseudo-rural road, had a chintzy Sentry Co. alarm system that fed, idiotically enough, on a whole separate 330-volt AC 90-hertz cable with its own meter. Didn't seem to be on anything like a regular PM patrol route, and had, at its rear, flimsily tasteful French doors, surrounded by dense and thorn-free deciduous shrubbery, and blocked off from the garage's halogen floods by a private EWD-issue upscale dumpster. It was, in short, a real cocktease of a home, burglary-wise, for a drug addict. And Don Gately straight shunted the alarm's meter and, with an associate, broke and entered and crept around on huge cat feet.
16.
Except, unfortunately, The owner of the house turned out to be still home, even though both of his cars and the rest of his family were gone. The little guy was asleep, sick in bed upstairs, in acetate pajamas, with a hot water bottle on his chest, and half a glass of OJ, and a bottle of NyQuil, and a foreign book and copies of International Affairs and Interdependent Affairs, and a pair of thick specs, and an industrial-sized box of Kleenex on the bedside table, and an empty vaporizer barely humming at the foot of the bed. And the guy was, to say the least, nonplussed, to wake up and see high-filter flashlights crisscrossing over the unlit bedroom walls and bureau, antique chiffonier, as Gately and associates scanned for a wall safe, which, surprisingly, like 90% of people with wall safes, conceal in their master bedroom behind some sort of land or seascape painting.
17.
People turned out so identical in certain root domestic particulars it made Gately feel strange sometimes. Like he was in possession of certain overlarge private facts to which no man should be entitled. Gately had a way stickier conscience about the possession of some of these large particular facts than he did about making off with other people's personal merchandise. But then, all of a sudden, in mid-silent search for a safe, here's this upscale homeowner turning out to be home with a nasty head cold while his family's out on a two-car foliage tour in what's left of the Berkshires, writhing groggily and NyQuilized around on the bed and making honking adenoidal sounds and asking what in bloody hell is the meaning of this, except he's saying it in Quebecois French, which means to these thuggish U.S. drug addicts in Halloween clowns masks exactly nothing. He's sitting up in bed, a little and older type homeowner with a football-shaped head and gray Van Dyke and eyes you can tell are used to corrective lenses as he switches on the bright bedside lamp. Gately could easily have screwed out of there and never looked back. But here indeed, in the lamplight, is a seascape over next to the chiffonier. And the associate has a quick peek and reports that the safe behind it is to laugh at. It can be opened with harsh language, almost. And oral narcotics addicts tend to operate on an extremely rigid physical schedule of need and satisfaction. And Gately is at this moment firmly in the need part of the schedule. And so, D.W. Gately disastrously decides to go ahead and allow a non-violent burglary to become in effect a robbery, which the operative legal difference involves either violence or the coercive threat of same. And Gately draws himself up to his full menacing height and shines his flashlight in the little homeowner's roomy eyes and addresses him the way menacing criminals speak in popular entertainment. D's for T.H.'s. Various apocopes and so on, and takes hold of the guy's ear and conducts him down to a kitchen chair and binds his arms and legs to the chair with electrical cords neatly clipped from refrigerator and can opener and M Cafe brand automatic cafe au lait maker, binds him just short of gangrenously tight because he's hoping the Berkshire foliage is prime and the guy is going to be soloing in this chair for a good stretch of time. And Gately starts looking through the kitchen drawers for the silverware. Not the good silver for company silverware. That was in a calfskin case underneath some neatly folded old spare Christmas wrapping in a stunning hardwood with ivory inlay chest of drawers in the living room, where over 90% of upscale people's good silver is always hidden and has already been promoted and is piled just off the foyer.
18.
But just the regular old everyday flatware silverware, because the vast bulk of homeowners keep their dish towels two drawers below their everyday silverware drawer. And God's made no better call for help stifling gag in the world than a good old, oily smelling, fake linen dish towel. And the bound guy in the cords on the chair suddenly snaps to the implications of what Gately's looking for and is struggling and saying, "Do not gag me. I have a terrible cold. My nose, she is a brick of the snot. I have not the power to breathe through the nose. For the love of God, please do not gag my mouth." And as a gesture of goodwill, the homeowner tells Gately, who's rummaging, the combination of the bedroom's seascape safe, except in French numbers, which, together with the honking adenoidal inflection the guy's grip gives his speech, Doesn't even sound like human speech to Gately. But also, the guy tells Gately, there are some antique, pre-British takeover, Quebecois gold coins in a calfskin purse, taped to the back of an undistinguished impressionist landscape in the living room. But everything the Canadian homeowner says means no more to poor old Don Gately, whistling a jolly tune and trying to look menacing in his clown's mask, than the cries of, say, North Shore gulls or inland grackles. And sure enough, the towels are two drawers under the spoons. And here comes Gately across the kitchen, looking like a sort of bozo from hell. And the Quebecer guy's mouth goes oval with horror, and into that mouth goes a balled-up, faintly greasy-smelling kitchen towel. And across the guy's cheeks, and over the dome of protruding linen, goes some fine-quality fibrous strapping tape from the drawer under the decommissioned phone. What does everybody keep the serious mailing supplies in the drawer nearest the kitchen phone? And Don Gately, an associate, finish their swift and, with the best of intentions, non-violent business of stripping the Brookline home as bare as a post-feral hamster meadow. And they relock the front door and hit the unlit road in Gately's reliable and double-mufflered 4x4. And the bound, wheezing, acetate-clad Canadian, the right-hand man to probably the most infamous anti-ONAN organizer north of the Great Concavity, the lieutenant and troubleshooting trusted advisor who selflessly volunteered to move with his family to the savagely American area of Metro Boston to act as liaison between and General Leashholder for the half dozen or so malevolent and mutually antagonistic groups of Quebecer separatists and Albertan ultra-rightists, united only in their fanatical conviction that the USA's ex-imperialistic gift or return of the so-called reconfigured Great Convexity to its northern neighbor and ONAN ally constituted an intolerable blow to Canadian sovereignty, honor, and hygiene. This homeowner, unquestionably a VIP, although admittedly rather a covert VIP, or probably more accurately a PIT in French.
19.
This meek-looking Canadian terrorism coordinator, bound to his chair, thoroughly gagged, sitting there, alone, under cold, fluorescent kitchen lights.
20.
The rhino, virally afflicted man, gagged with skill and quality materials. The guy, having worked so hard to partially clear one clotted nasal passage that he tore intercostal ligaments in his ribs, soon found even that pinprick of air blocked off by mucus's implacable lava-like flow once again, and so has to tear more ligaments trying to breach the other nostril, and so on. And after an hour of struggle and flames in his chest and blood on his lips and the white kitchen towel from trying frantically to tongue the towel out past the tape, which is quality tape, and after hopes skyrocketing when the doorbell rings, and then hopes blackly dashed when the person at the door, a young woman with a clipboard and chewing gum who's offering promotional coupons good for happy holidays discounts on memberships of 6 months or more at a string of Boston non-UV tanning salons, shrugs in her parka and makes a mark on the clipboard and blithely retreats down the long driveway to the pseudo-rural road. An hour of this or more, finally, the Quebecois PIT, after unspeakable agony, slow suffocation, mucoidal or no, being no day at the Montreal Tulip Fest, at the height of which agony, hearing his head's pulse as receding thunder and watching his vision circle shrink as a red aperture around his sight rotates steadily in from the edges, at the height of which he could think only, despite the pain and panic, of what a truly dumb and silly way this was, after all this time, to die. A thought which the towel and tape denied expression via the rueful grin with which the best men meet the dumbest ends. This Guillaume de Plessis passed bluely from this life and sat there in the kitchen chair, 250 clicks due east of some really spectacular autumn foliage, for almost two nights and days, his posture getting more and more military as rigor mortis set in, with his bare feet looking like purple loaves of bread from the lividity. And when Brookline's finest are finally summoned and got him unbound from the coldly lit chair, They had to carry him out as if he were still seated. So, militarily, Camille Faux had his limbs and spine hardened. And poor old Don Gately, whose professional habit of killing power with straight shunts to a meter's inflow was pretty much a signature M.O., and who had, of course, a special place in the heart of a remorseless revere with judicial clout throughout Boston's three counties and beyond, and, of course, particularly remorseless ADA as of late, whose wife now needed Valium even just to floss, and was patiently awaiting his chance, the ADA was, coldly biding his time, being a patient get-even and cold dish man just like Don Gately, who was, through no will to energy-consuming violence on his part, in this sort of a hell of a deep shit mess that can turn a man's life right around. Year of the Depends Adult Undergarment. Interlace Tell Entertainment. 932, 1864, RISC. Power TPs with or without console. Pink number 2. Post Prime Star DSS dissemination. Menus and icons. Pixel-free internet fax. Tri and quad modems with adjustable baud. Dissemination grids. Screens so high def you might as well be there. Cost-effective videophonic conferencing. Internal Frox CD-ROM. Electronic couture, all-in-one consoles. You shit you nanoprocessors. Laser chromatography. Virtual capable media cards. Fiber optic pulse. Digital encoding. Killer apps. Carpal neuralgia. Phosphenic migraine. Gluteal hyperadiposity. Lumbar stressy. November 3rd. Year of the Depend Adult Undergarment. Room 204. Subdormitory B. Jim Trolch, age 17. Hometown, Narberth, Pennsylvania. Current Enfield Tennis Academy rank in boys 18s, number 8, which puts him at number 2 singles on the 18s B team. Has been taken ill. Again. It came on as he was suiting up warmly for the B squad's 07 45 hours drills. A cartridge of a round of 16 match from September's US Open had been on the small room viewer with the sound all the way down as usual. And Trolch had been straightening the straps on his jock, idly calling the match's action into his fist when it came on. The illness. It came out of nowhere. His breathing all of a sudden started hurting the back of his throat. Then that overfull heat in various cranial meatus. Then he squeezed, and the stuff he sneezed out was thick and doughy. It came on ultra fast and out of the pre-drill blue. He's back in bed now, supine, watching the match's fourth set but not calling the action. The viewers, right under Pemulus's poster of the Paranoid King, that you can't escape looking at if you want to look at the viewer.
21.
Plotted Kleenex litter the floor around his bed's wastebasket. The bedside table is littered with both OTC and prescription expectorants and pertussives and analgesics and vitamin C mega spanules and one bottle of Benadryl and one of Seldane.
22.
Only the Seldane bottle actually contains several attenuate 75 milligram capsules Trolch has incrementally promoted from Pemulus's part of the room and has, rather ingeniously he thinks, stashed in bold, plain sight in a bedside pill bottle where the Peemster would never think to check. Trolch is the sort that can feel his own forehead and detect fever. It's definitely a rhinovirus, the sudden severe kind. He speculated on if yesterday when Graham Raider pretended to sneeze on Jay Trolch's lunch tray at the milk dispenser at lunch, if Raider might have really sneezed and only pretended to pretend, transferring virulent rhinoviri to Trolch's delicate mucosa. He feverishly, mentally calls down various cosmic retributions on Raider. Neither of Trolch's roommates is here. Ted Schacht is getting the knees first of several whirlpools for the day, Pemulus has geared up and left for 0745 drills. Trolch offered Pemulus rights to his breakfast to fill up his vaporizer for him and call the first shift nurse for yet more Seldane nuclear-grade antihistamine and a dextromethorphan nebulizer and a written excuse from AM drills. He lies there sweating freely, watching digitally recorded professional tennis, too worried about his throat to feel loquacious enough to call the action. Seldane is not supposed to make you drowsy, but he feels weak and unpleasantly drowsy. He can barely make a fist. He's sweaty. Nausea slash vomiting like not an impossibility by any means. He cannot believe how fast it came on. The illness. The vaporizer seethes and burps, and all four of the room's windows weep against the outside cold. There are the sad, tiny, distant champagne cork sounds of scores of balls being hit down at the east courts. Trolch drifts at a level just above sleep. Enormous ATH-SCME, displacement fans, far up north at the wall, and Border's distant roar, and the outdoor voices and pock of cold balls create a kind of sound carpet below the digestive sounds of the vaporizer and the squeak of Trolch's bedsprings as he thrashes and twitches in a moist half-sleep. He has heavy German eyebrows and big knuckled hands. It's one of those unpleasant opioid feverish half-sleep states. More a fugue state than a sleep state, less a floating than like being cast adrift on rough seas, tossed mightily in and out of this half-sleep, where your mind's still working, and you can ask yourself whether you're asleep even as you dream. And any dreams you do have seem ragged at the edges, gnawed on, incomplete. It's literally daydreaming. Sick. The kind of incomplete fugue you awake from with a sort of psychic clunk, struggling up to sit upright, convinced there's someone unauthorized in the dorm room with you, falling back sick on his circle-stained pillow, staring straight up into the prolix folds of the Turkish blanketish thing pendulous and shocked had crazy glued to the ceiling's corners, which billows, hanging, so its folds form a terrain, like with valleys and shadows. I am coming to see that the sensation of the worst nightmares, a sensation that can be felt asleep or awake, is identical to those worst dreams form itself. The sudden intra-dream realization that the nightmare's very essence and center has been with you all along, even awake. It's just been overlooked. And then that horrific interval between realizing that you've overlooked and turning your head to look back at what's been right there, all along, the whole time. Your first nightmare away from home and folks. Your first night at the academy. It was there all along. The dream is that you awaken from a deep sleep. Wake up suddenly damp and panicked and are overwhelmed with the sudden feeling that there is a distillation of total evil in this dark, strange sub-dorm room with you. That evil's essence and center is right here in this room right now and is for you alone. None of the other little boys in the room are awake. The bunk above yours sags, dead, motionless. No one moves. No one else in the room feels the presence of something radically evil. None thrash or sit damply up. No one else cries out. Whatever it is not evil for them. The flashlight your mother name-tagged with masking tape and packed for you special. Hands around the institutional room, the drop ceiling, the gray striped mattress, and bulged grid of bunk springs above you, the two other bunk beds, another matte gray that won't return light, the piles of books and compact discs and tapes and tennis gear, your disc of white light trembling like the moon on water as it plays over the identical bureaus, the recessions of closet, and room's front door. Doors frames belections. The cone of light pans over fixtures. The lumpy jumbles of sleeping boys' shadows on the snuff-white walls. The two rag throw rugs ovals on the hardwood floor. black lines of baseboards reglets. The cracks in the Venetian blinds that ooze the violet non-light of a night with snow and just a hook of moon. A flashlight with your name in maternal cursive plays over every centimeter of the walls. Rheostats, CD, interlaced poster of Tony Kondo, phone console, desks, TPs, the face in the floor, posters of prose, the onion skin yellow of the desk lamp's shades, the ceiling panel's patterns of pinholes, the grid of upper bunk's springs, recession of closet and door, boys wrapped in blankets, slight crack like a creek's course in the eastward ceiling, discernible now, maple reglet border at seam of ceiling, and walls north and south. No floor has a face, your flashlight showed, but didn't know, never did see its eyes, pupils set sideways and tapered like a cat's, its eyebrows V and the horrid toothy smile leering right at your light all the time you've been scanning. Oh, mother, a face in the floor. Mother, oh. And your flashlight's beam stabs jaggedly back for the overlooked face, misses it, overcorrects, then centers on what you'd felt but had seen without seeing just now, as you'd so carefully panned the light and looked, a face in the floor there all the time but unfelt by all others, and unseen by you until you knew just as you felt it didn't belong and was evil. Evil. And then its mouth opens at your light. And then you wake like that, quivering like a struck drum, lying there awake and quivering, summoning courage and spit, roll to the right just as in the dream for the name tag flashlight on the floor by the bed just in case, lie there on your shank and side, shining the light all over just as in the dream, lie there panning, looking, all ribs and elbows and dilated eyes. The awake floor is littered with gear and dirty clothes, blonde hardwood with sealed seams, two throw rugs, the bare waxed wood shiny in the window's snowlight, the floor neutral, faceless. You cannot see any face in the floor. Awake, lying there, faceless, blank, dilated, playing beam over floor again and again. Not sure all night, forever, unsure you're not missing something that's right there. You lie there, awake at almost 12, believing with all your might. As of year of the Depend Adult Undergarment. The Enfield Tennis Academy has been in accredited operation for 3 pre-subsidized years, and then 8 subsidized years. First, under the direction of Dr. James Incandenza, and then under the administration of his half-brother-in-law, Charles Tavis, Education's Director. James Orrin Incandenza, the only child of a former top U.S. junior tennis player, and then promising young pre-method actor who, during the interval of J.O. Incandenza's early formative years, had become a disrespected and largely unemployable actor, driven back to his native Tucson, Arizona, and dividing his remaining energies between stints as a tennis pro at ranch-type resorts, and then short-run productions at something called the Desert Beat Theater Project. The father, a dipsomaniacal tragedian, progressively crippled by obsessions with death, by spider bite, and by stage fright, and with a bitterness of ambiguous origin but consuming intensity toward the method school of professional acting and its more promising exponents. A father who, somewhere around the nadir of his professional fortunes, apparently decided to go down to his raid-sprayed basement workshop and build a promising junior athlete the way other fathers might restore vintage autos, or build ships inside bottles, or like refinished chairs, etc. James Incandenza proved a withdrawn but compliant student of the game, and soon a gifted junior player. Tall, bespectacled, domineering at net, who used tennis scholarships to finance on his own private secondary and then higher education at places just about as far away from the U.S. Southwest as one could get without drowning. The United States government's prestigious ONR financed his doctorate in optical physics, fulfilling something of a childhood dream.
23.
His strategic value during the federal interval, G Ford to early G Bush, as more or less the top applied geometrical optics man in the ONR and SAC, designing neutron scattering reflectors for thermostrategic weapons systems, then in the Atomic Energy Commission, where his development of gamma refractive indices for lithium anodized lenses and panels is commonly regarded as one of the big half dozen discoveries that made possible cold annular fusion and approximate energy independence for the US and its various allies and protectorates. His optical acumen translated, after an early retirement from the public sector, into a patented fortune in rearview mirrors, light-sensitive eyewear, holographic birthday and Christmas greeting cartridges, videophonic tableau, homolocine cartography software, non-fluorescent public lighting systems, and film equipment. Then, in the optative retirement from hard science that building and opening a USTA-accredited and pedagogically experimental tennis academy apparently represented for him, into avant-garde experimental and conceptual film work, too far either ahead of or behind its time, possibly, to be much appreciated at the time of his death in the year of the trial-sized Dove Bar. Although a lot of it, the experimental and conceptual film work, was admittedly just plain pretentious and unengaging and bad, and probably not helped at all by the man's very gradual spiral into the crippling dipsomania of his late father.
24.
The tall, ungainly, socially challenged, and hard-drinking Dr. Incandenza's May-December marriage to one of the few bona fide bombshell-type females in North American academia, the extremely tall and high-strung but also extremely pretty and gainly and teetotaling and classy Dr. Avril Mondragon.
25.
The only female academic ever to hold the McDonald chair in prescriptive usage at the Royal Victoria College of McGill University, whom Incandenza met at a U Toronto conference on reflective versus reflexive systems, was rendered even more romantic by the bureaucratic tribulations involved in obtaining an exit and then an entrance visa, to say nothing of a green card. For even a U.S. spoused Professor Mondragon, whose involvement, however demonstrably nonviolent, with certain members of the Quebecois separatist left, while in graduate school, had placed her name on the RCMP's notorious
Personne qui en doit se veiller attentivement list.
The birth of the Incandenza's first child, Oren, had been at least partly a legal maneuver. It is known that during the last 5 years of his life, Dr. James O. Incandenza liquidated his assets and patent licenses, ceded control over most of the Enfield Tennis Academy's operations to his wife's half-brother, a former engineer most recently employed in amateur sports administration at Throppinghamshire Provincial College, New Brunswick, Canada, and devoted his unimpaired hours almost exclusively to the production of documentaries, technically recondite art films, and mordantly obscure and obsessive dramatic cartridges, leaving behind a substantial, given the late age at which he bloomed creatively, number of completed films and cartridges, some of which have earned a small academic following for their technical feck and for a pathos that was somehow both surreally abstract and CNS-rendingly melodramatic at the same time. Professor James O. Incandenza Jr.'s untimely suicide at 54 was held a great loss in at least three worlds. President J. Gentle, FC, acting on behalf of the USDD's ONR and ONAN's post-annular AEC, conferred a posthumous citation and conveyed his condolences by classified ARPA net electronic mail. Incandenza's burial in Quebec's Lillet County was twice delayed by annular hyperfloration cycles. Cornell University Press announced plans for a festschrift. Certain leading young, quote, avant-garde and anti-confluential filmmakers employed in their output for the year of the trial-sized Dove Bar certain oblique visual gestures, most involving the chiaroscuro lamping and custom lens effects for which Incandenza's distinctive deep focus was known. that paid the sort of deep insider's elegiac tribute no audience could be expected to notice. An interview with Incandenza was posthumously included in a book on the genesis of annulation, and those of ETA's junior players, whose hypertrophied arms could fit inside them, wore black armbands on court for almost a year. Denver, Colorado, the 1st of November, year of the Depend adult undergarment.
I hate this!
Orin yells out to whoever glides near. He doesn't loop or spiral like the showboats. He sort of tacks, the gliding equivalent of snow plowing. Unspectacular, and aiming to get it over ASAP and intact. The fake red wings nylon clatters in an updraft. Ill-glued feathers keep peeling off and rising. The updraft is the oxides from Mile High's thousands of open mouths. Far and away the loudest stadium anyplace. He feels like a dick. The beak makes it hard to breathe and see. Two reverse ends do some kind of combined barrel roll thing. The worst is the moment right before they make the jump off the stadium's rim. Hands in the top rows reaching and clutching. People laughing. The interlaced cameras panning and tightening. Orin knows too well the light on the side that means zoom. Once they're out over the field, the voices melt and merge into oxides and updraft. The left guard is soaring up instead of down. A couple beaks and a claw fall off somebody and go pinwheeling down toward the green. Orin tacks grimly back and forth. He's among those who steadfastly refuse to whistle or squawk, bonus or no. The stadium's loudspeakers, a steely gargle. You can never hear it clearly, even on the ground. The sad old ex-quarterback, who now just holds on place kicks, falls in beside Orin's slow back and forth, about 100 meters over the 40. He's one of the token females, his beak blunter and wings red, non-garish.
Hate and loathe this with a cluster fucking passion, Clate.
The holder tries to make a resigned wing gesture and is almost blown into Orin's pin feathers.
Almost down. Enjoy the ride. Yo, cleavage check in 22G, just by the...
And then lost in the roar as the first player touches down and sheds the red-feathered promotional apparatus. You have to scream to even be heard. At some point, it starts sounding like the crowd's roaring at its own roar. A doubling back quality like something'll blow. One of the Broncos in the rear end of a costume takes a header at midfield so it looks like the thing's ass went flying off. Orin has told no cardinal, not even his team's counselor and visualization therapist, about his morbid fear of heights and high-altitude descent.
I punt! I'm paid! To punt long, high, well, and always. Making me do personal interviews on my personal side's bad enough. But this crosses every line. Why do we stand for this? I'm an athlete. I'm not a freak show performer. Nobody mentioned flying at the trade table. In New Orleans, it was just robes and halos, and once a season, a zither. But just once a season. This is fucking awful. Could be worse.
Spiraling down toward the line of X's and the bill-capped guys that help strip the wings off. Runty, pot-bellied volunteer front office connected guys, who always smirk in a way you couldn't quite level the accusation.
I'm paid to punt. It's worse in Philly. Had fucking water drops in Seattle for 3 seasons.
Please, Lord, spare the leg, Orin whispers each time just before touchdown.
Of how you could be an Oiler. You could be a Brown.
The organo-psychedelic muscimol, an isoxazole alkaloid derived from Amanita muscaria, a.k.a. the fly agaric mushroom. By no means, Michael Pamulis emphasizes, to be confused